and to wish the city of Los Angeles a happy St. Patrick's Day. We're here today with the Lions Academy of Irish Dance from San Pedro. Once again, these talented dance athletes are here with us today. And I want, again, I want to wish you all the blessings of St. Patrick's Day, or as we say in Irish, Benecta Nefala Porc Ort. We celebrate St. Patrick's Day across this country and across the world. And here in this country, sometimes it gets reduced to wear green or you get pinched. As your former lawyer, I would recommend against the pinching. Green beer or having puns about leprechauns. And all of that is fun, of course. But really, this is an opportunity here in the States and around the world to recognize the important cultural contributions of the Irish people in Europe and in the diaspora across the world. And so I am really pleased today that once again we're going to be able to wish Los Angeles a happy St. Patrick's Day with these great dancers, these athletes, these cultural icons in San Pedro. And I'm going to call out their names before I ask them to begin. Their names are Ashlyn Blythe, McKenna Gephardt, Audrey Donovan, Elise Dermody, Emma Cabuzzi, Addison Archer, and their great instructor, Meredith Lyons. With that, let's call forward the dancers. again for these dance artists and athletes. Again, Ashlyn, McKenna, Audrey, Elise, Emma, and Addison, thank you so much. And their instructor, who's a treasure in San Pedro and around the region, Meredith Lyons, who I remember when she was dancing with my nieces. Thank you so much. Members, I'm also thrilled to announce that next week, the Consul General, McKenna Smith, is going to be visiting us. She is traveling with the Prime Minister of Ireland now and concluding her travels at the White House on Sunday, where President Joe Biden is going to be hosting a reception for the Prime Minister, or the TISA, of Ireland. And fortunately, I've been invited to represent Los Angeles at that reception, so we will come back on Tuesday, and the Consul General and one of the ministers of Ireland will be with us again. So I'll ask you, make sure you hang on to your flags. You can take them down, but put them back up on Tuesday, okay? I want to also bring up Meredith and the girls and present you with a certificate. Why don't you come around this way?
All right, and as they're coming up, Council Member, we got a couple, we got a member on the queue.
Excellent.
That would like to speak. Council Member Rodriguez.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. McCosker. To these incredible young ladies, thank you so much for the performance this morning. Please, colleagues, another round of applause. They were outstanding. And I want to thank you, Mr. McCosker, for bringing up, you know, it is our cultural contributions, and there's a long history, obviously, of the Irish influence in the beginnings of our country's history. But so many of our cultures, unfortunately, get misrepresented in our contributions to the history of America. And it is, you know, St. Patrick's Day is more than just green beer and pitching and shamrocks, and it's so much more. Unfortunately, similarly, the confusion for so many people exists with, for example, the celebration of Cinco de Mayo and Mexican independence. It happens all the time. And it's some of the similarities that our communities have shared over the course of history. There's a very deep kinship and friendship amongst the Latino community and the Irish community. And I just want to thank you, ladies, for bringing to the fore this incredible history, the traditional dance, and it's so beautiful to watch. Your posture is incredible. I know this is, that's tough, but I think it's really, it's impressive, and I just appreciate so much how hard I know it, how much work goes into preserving that cultural history and that dance. I know it takes a lot of work, a lot of dedication, and I just want, and I sound like I'm actually a judge for Dancing with the Stars right now, but I just want to say thank you so much for gracing us with the performance this morning and helping to remind everybody how pivotal every single part of our cultural history is here in the country and, of course, here in the city of Los Angeles. Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Mr. McCosker.
So much. I do want to follow on that. That's an excellent point. I mean, I will, as a homework assignment, we should all look up the San Patricios. The San Patricios, the band of Irish fighters who joined the Mexican side in the Mexican-American War because they felt more, a deeper kinship with the Mexicans who were fighting for their own survival. So that's a homework assignment, and it's a great story. So thank you very much, Council Member, for pointing out that deep kinship. I want to present to the Lions Academy of Irish Dance, to their instructor, who herself is a champion dancer, and to these wonderful athletes, a certificate of recognition on behalf of the City of Los Angeles and the 1-5. Thank you for sharing your extraordinary talents with this community on St. Patrick's Day. I know this is a busy time for you, so make sure you stretch and hydrate and be well. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Come forward. Let's bring the certificate and the ladies forward, and we'll do it this way.
Hold it.
How's that? Yes, you hold it. Oh, the young ladies can hold it. Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Can I make one more announcement?
Yes, sir.
I just want to say that also for our Irish, for our St. Patrick's Day celebrations on tomorrow. We'll be celebrating in the heart of San Pedro's Little Italy at 6th and Mesa from 3 to 7 p.m. We're going to be having our second annual Gaelic and garlic celebration. And you all know how the Italian community is so important in San Pedro. And in Little Italy, the Italian community said, how do we celebrate our new council member? And I said, how about Gaelic and garlic, which I stole from another group. But it'll be great fun. It'll be 3 to 7. We're going to have Irish dancers again. Make sure you stretch and hydrate. And we're going to have an Italian Elvis who sings songs. We can sing along. We'll have spaghetti and corned beef and meatballs and shamrock cookies and cannolis. So, as we say in each of our cultures, shlante and saluti. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Another big round of applause for our dancers and our own Councilmember McCosker. I'm happy to know we'll be represented in the White House for the St. Patrick's Day celebration. All right, with that, Clerk, I'm going to ask that we begin by calling the roll.
Yes, sir. Blumenfield, De Leon, Harris, Dawson, Hernandez, Hutt, Krikorian, Lee, McCosker, Padilla, Park, Price, Rahman, Rodriguez, Soto, Martinez, Yaroslavsky, 11 members present, and a quorum, Mr. President.
All right. First order of business.
Approval of the minutes of March 8th, 2024.
All right. Councilmember Hernandez moves. Councilmember Lee seconds. What's next?
Commendatory resolutions for approval.
All right. Councilmember Rahman moves. Councilmember Soto Martinez seconds. Next.
Mr. President, there is a request to hold item 1 on the desk.
All right, without objection. And before we go to go through the agenda, I'm going to ask Councilmember Rodriguez to lead us in a very, very special presentation.
All right, thank you so much, colleagues. Good morning. It's, you know, we're unfortunately having to conduct these a little more frequently than I care to do. But today we are celebrating the incredible tenure of a man who has dedicated himself to public service, someone that we all really have come to treasure because of his very gentle and firm way of preserving history, helping us understand all of, I mean, you've been really a lot like a historian, but also someone who has really done an incredible job in managing and leading and collaborating with all of us to address some of the most challenging times of our LA Police Department's history, and that is none other than Mr. Richard T. Fink. Most of us know Mr. T. Fink as the sharpest dressed man at LAPD. But today we are saying goodbye and celebrating the career of a man who has worked tirelessly for over 20 years behind the scenes to ensure this city's police commission is run well, open, and transparently.
So, hold on, Ms. Rodriguez. You. General Dogon, this is your first warning. Please stop disrupting the meeting. If you're not going to stop disrupting the meeting, we're going to ask you to excuse yourself. This is your last warning. Ms. Rodriguez.
That's it.
All right, that's it.
That's it.
Ms. General Dogon, please exit the building. Sergeants will ask you to see General Dogon out of the room.
So, General Dogon, you've been warned twice now, and now you've been excused from the meeting. So please exit the meeting quietly. Thank you.
Please leave the room quietly. All right. He's exited the room. Ms. Rodriguez.
Thank you. Going back to celebrating the sharpest dressed man at LAPD. We are saying goodbye and celebrating the career of a man that has worked tirelessly for over 20 years behind the scenes to ensure City's police commission is run in an open and transparent way. The Mr. President, if we could just inform the sergeants to identify those that are disrupting the meeting.
Yes, there are people, multiple people who are shouting out in the back of the room. We'll ask the sergeants to identify them. We'll warn you once, and the second time you'll be excused, just like the prior person.
Thank you. Mr. T. Fink was born outside of Manhattan, New York, in Weehawken, New Jersey, before being honorably discharged for his service for 4 years in the United States Air Force. Richard moved to California, where he graduated from Cal State University, Los Angeles, with a bachelor's degree in police administration. He began his law enforcement career as a police officer for the city of Montclair a year later in 1968. In 1972, he moved to the Pomona Police Department, where he later became chief of police in 1986. While the city of Pomona was going through some political distress, Mr. T. Fink defended his officers at great risk to his career. After leaving Pomona, Richard was recruited to serve as the police chief for the Buena Park Police Department, where he stayed until 2001. As if serving as the police chief wasn't tough enough, Richard also served as president of the Orange County Chief and Sheriff's Association in 1995 and president of the California Police Association Chiefs Association in 1999. Upon leaving Buena Park, he began serving the residents of Los Angeles when he joined the Los Angeles Police Commission's office as the Inspector General, as an Assistant Inspector General on December 1st, 2003. Just over a year later, the Board of Police Commissioners appointed Richard to serve as the Executive Director of the Los Angeles Police Commission on May 27th, 2004. While guiding the board's actions, he helped with the selection of two chiefs of police, Charlie Beck, Michael Moore, and the reappointment of three chiefs of police, William Bratton, Charlie Beck, and Michael Moore, and the selection of three inspector generals. It's no surprise that he did not serve the city of Los Angeles without facing a number of tough challenges. He helped with many challenges, including navigating the consent decree, the aftermath of the 2007 May Day incident, and the 2020 civil unrest, as well as the COVID-19 pandemic. During his tenure as executive director, Richard has worked with 28 commissioners and five chiefs of police, establishing more transparency and accountability with the implementation of both vehicle and body-worn cameras and making all police commission agenda materials available online. He has been someone committed to honesty, accountability, and impartiality in law enforcement, and the uses of these principles on a daily basis to guide and advise both commissioners and department staff. Richard's exceptional contributions to local communities and public safety have been significant in forever altering and improving the fabric of the Los Angeles Police Department for generations to come. You know, when I first became chair, actually when I first became a member of the Public Safety Committee, when I joined the council and then subsequently becoming chair of Public Safety, it was Richard that I got a lot of deep dive in on the history, because it's really important to know where we're charting out new courses, that we know where we've come from. And he is someone that has been very responsive, very available and accessible to so many of us to help us be better informed about the history and the practice of law enforcement here in the city of Los Angeles, and drawing on his many years of service, as I shared previously, he is someone that understands the balance and the dynamic of what the role entails. And so it's really, it's a huge loss. I feel like we're, like I said, we're having too many of these moments, but there was no one that I didn't want to miss this opportunity to celebrate someone that has given so much, and Marilyn's here too. And you know, I remember at one of the holiday parties, Marilyn's always quick with their pictures of Mr. T. Fink with his mutton chops. And you know, just there's so much of himself reflected in this department, in the commission and the work that they do. He has just been an incredible resource to so many of us. And you know, it's always hard to have these moments, but it was really important that we celebrate the incredible contributions of public services that this man has not only given to our city, to many other cities and municipalities, but to our country in service in the military. And so I thank you, Mr. T. Fink, for your incredible friendship, for your stewardship, work and service to the commission and the city of Los Angeles. And at this time, I'd like to introduce our assistant chief, Blake Chow, for some remarks.
Thank you, council member Richard. Council members, you know, I just wanted to come up here and say a few words for Richard, because he has been a very special person to me, as well as everybody that's here in the department, as well as the region, as a council member had so eloquently recapped. His service to this community and this region goes back not just the 20 years that he was with LAPD, but well over 50 years in the different positions he's had. So he spent 50 years of his life trying to help others. And, you know, Mr. T, as we so affectionately call him, you know, through life, if you're lucky enough to meet people who actually stand out, that have character, that have heart, that who are giants, that not only change organizations, but influence the lives and the careers of others, and who are generally good souls, we can only be so lucky to hope that we meet somebody like that as in the course of our life. But I can say that I have, and I can say that we have, and it's this man standing next to me. As was mentioned, Mr. T has served as the executive director of the Los Angeles Police Commission for over 20 years. And I know that I, as well as many others, are extremely grateful for him. For me personally, Mr. T. Fank came on into the city council right after I made captain, and he's just always been there. And it's going to be unusual, Richard, not to have you there. But you know, as he is our rock, he's helped us as the council member mentioned, navigate through some very difficult times. He's always been there as a representative of the police commission. He was always there to give us insight as to what they were thinking, and actually give us insight as to how to navigate some of the sensitive issues that have come up over the last 20 years. But more importantly, he's always been a mentor and a friend to many of us, and always available. Richard is always available. And I will second that, council member. He is the best dressed man in LAPD. So I won't recap everything that Richard's done, but you could hear that he's been many places and done many things. And I just wanted to congratulate you, Richard, on behalf of Los Angeles Police Department, because, you know, quite honestly, we are all better people for having met you and having worked for you. So congratulations.
Thanks, Chief.
Thank you so much. I want to call on members of the council before we go to the star of the morning. Councilmember Lee.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Councilmember Rodriguez, for honoring this great man. You know, Mr. T. Fink, I've been with the city a little over 20 years. I don't know what the city's like without you in the position where you've been. You know, I want to thank you for your years of city service, but really I want to thank you for always being such an incredible partner with my office, addressing the different issues that we face, not only in the city, but especially in Council District 12. You're one of those resources that is the first person we turn to when there's an issue or a problem that we need to solve, or different things or technology or whatever it is to look at. You seem to be that first phone call that we reach out to get your advice on those many issues. So I don't know how we feel that without you here. And so I just really appreciate the time you've given to this great city that, you know, we all love so much. You have truly made an incredible impact, and I hope you know that. I hope you know the impact that you've made on the city with your service and to the LAPD. It's, you know, when you look around you and you see the commanders and the chiefs that are here, they're here because they respect you and they wanted to be here to honor you. And I can just say it's well deserved. And I want to just again tell you how much I personally appreciate everything that you've done for the city of Los Angeles.
Mr. McCosker.
Richard, Mr. T. Fank, it's hard to believe this day is here. I can't believe it. It was threatened and rethreatened and rethreatened and pushed off, and finally here. I've appreciated all the relationships we've had over 25 years and different roles, different capacities for me, you mostly in this capacity, but not entirely. And I remember each time that I would seek your advice or think I was telling you something I knew. And what I really, really appreciate about you is that you always spoke honestly. Every single time I spoke to you, and I think every single time you spoke to anybody in the department, I never saw a moment where you were thinking to yourself, what does the chief want me to say? Or what do the rank and file want me to say? Or what would be good for me not getting yelled at right now? You are honest and courageous and forthright and wise. And so I appreciate all that you've done for the people of the city of Los Angeles over these many years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Rodriguez.
Thank you so much, colleagues, and thank you, Mr. McCosker. I think you've nailed it. And again, I want to acknowledge everyone that's here from command, from the administrative staff, everyone that has come out to celebrate and honor you for all of your years of service. Ladies and gentlemen, our special guest today, whose work we treasure and appreciate, Mr. Richard T. Fink.
Thank you, Councilmember Rodriguez. I'm honored and humbled. I don't know what else to say. I look at those pictures up there, and I don't know where that young man went, but he went somewhere. But first of all, I have to thank my wife, Marilyn. March 5th, we celebrated our 47th wedding anniversary. And without her, I would have never been able to accomplish all the things I've accomplished in my career, and certainly would not be here. When I took the job at the Inspector General's office, I told her, I'll do it for a couple of years. It'd be kind of fun to do it. Here I am a few years later, and she's let me stay. Begrudgingly in the last few years, but she's let me stay. Working for the City of Los Angeles and the LAPD has been the highlight of my over 55-year career in law enforcement. I have had opportunities and exposure to things I never would have had the opportunity to see in my career. I hope that I have made a difference in the LAPD and the City of Los Angeles. I always try to be responsive to every member of the council, every member of the CAO and the CLA staff, all of your staffs that I've worked with over the years. I hope I've been as responsive to them as they have been responsive to me. I leave this position with a great deal of satisfaction and also sadness. Satisfaction in that I think I've accomplished something, but sadness I'm leaving behind something I really enjoy and have a passion for. I've been blessed in my time in Los Angeles and at the Commission to have wonderful staff, some of who are sitting over here, some who have obviously come and they moved on into retirement or other positions. Without the staff, I could have done none of this. It's the staff that gets the credit for everything that I have accomplished. To the men and women of LAPD, I respect you so much for what you do, how you do it. You are the top law enforcement agency in the country, in my mind. I've been around, I've seen a lot of law enforcement agencies, and no one leads like the LAPD does. When anyone wants to know what's going on, they call the LAPD. I get calls from around the country weekly from other police commissions, other executives, city council members. What does LA do about this? I think the city is a leader in police oversight. City is a leader in the police department and the programs you're implementing and unarmed response, et cetera, and continue with that great work. And it's been my honor and pleasure to serve the city of LA. And I'm very humbled and gracious, and thank you for all the kind words you've said and for taking care of me and my family for the past 20 years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. T. Fink. Colleagues, Mr. T. Fink, on behalf of the Los Angeles City Council, thank you so much for your dedicated service to the people of Los Angeles, our Los Angeles Police Department, and thank you for, and Marilyn, you've earned this just as much as he did. Wishing you the very best in your retirement.
Thank you, ma'am.
One more time for our special guest today. So grateful to you on behalf of the Los Angeles City Council. All right, we'll prepare for our next presentation, which will be led by our own council member, Tracy Park. Ms. Park.
Thank you, Council President. As we celebrate Women's History Month and acknowledge so many accomplishments and progress already made, the sad reality is that there remains much work to be done addressing violence against women, which still remains one of the most prevalent human rights violations around the world. Globally, an estimated 736 million women and girls, almost one in three, have been subjected to physical and/or sexual violence. Here in the United States, nearly 3 out of 10 women have experienced rape, physical violence, or stalking by an intimate partner. Violence against women, because of their political activism or simply the fact of their gender, remains a problem around the world. Designated by the United Nations General Assembly and acknowledged worldwide since 1981, the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women has the world united in taking a stance against such atrocities. The day was selected in honor of the Mirabal sisters, three political activists from the Dominican Republic who were brutally murdered in 1960 by the country's regime as a result of their political activities. And just last year, the world witnessed horrific acts of sexual violence against Jewish and Israeli women. I'm proud today to be joined by a number of fearless men and women and who are advocates at the forefront of ending violence against women around the world. Among others, I am joined here today by Gina Raphael, the chair of WISO California, Nate Looney, the Director of Community Safety and Belonging for the Jewish Federations of North America, Carmel Halevi, Consul for Public Diplomacy with the Israeli Consulate, and Talia, a survivor of the Nova Music Festival massacre that occurred on October 7th last year. Like the Mirabal sisters, we must uplift and call attention to these atrocities so that we can end violence against women around the world once and for all. It is now my honor to introduce Gina Raphael to offer some brief remarks.
Thank you so much. My name is Gina Raphael. I am a small business owner, advocate for adoption, a mother of three adopted daughters, and an animal rights activist. Mother of three rescue dogs. Thank you. I am honored to serve as chairperson of WITSO, the Women's International Zionist Organization. Founded in 1920 in pre-state Israel, WITSO has been working for 104 years to help women, children, and seniors in Israel. With more than 800 social services projects, WITSO is the largest social services provider in Israel outside of the government. We help individuals of all backgrounds, Jews, Muslims, Christians, Druze, and many more. We stand today strong as Zionists with over 50 women here with our partners from ICANN, WITSO, Shar Sheret, AJC, Shelters for Israel, Club C, Jewish National Fund, Beth Jacob, High Center, the Jewish Federation of Greater Los Angeles, and National Jewish Federations, and other organizations. Given the atrocities committed by Hamas against women and girls in Israel, women were raped, brutalized, their genitalia removed when Israel was attacked on October 7th. And then there were those that were taken in captivity and the horrors committed against them there. We have 19 young women still in captivity solely because they are Jewish, held against their will and continue to be brutalized, tortured, raped. We vow to bring them home and ensure never again. We must speak up for all violence so that the weaponization of sexual violence will not be part of conflicts around the world. We must bring home the 100 hostages that remain. Within Israel, we stand committed to help our brothers and sisters with therapy, housing, healing, and activities for displaced families. We vow to bring them to their home communities instead of being spread throughout the country. We have helped 150,000 Israelis relocated by the war. We vow that we will bring laughter and joy to children on the playgrounds, so that will be the sounds that they hear, not the sounds of sirens for them running for cover. At home in Los Angeles, we remain committing to fighting the scourge of hatred and anti-Semitism. We thank you, Councilmember Park. We thank you, Councilmember Yaroslavsky. And we thank Council President Krikorian for having us here today. We thank you as well for the Jewish community, which our children represent 18% of the population in Los Angeles. We thank each and every one of you for standing with the Jewish community, the people of Israel, and what is right. Thank you again. Am Yisrael Chai, the people of Israel live, and Shabbat Shalom.
Gina, thank you so much for your remarks and your leadership.
Sorry, whoever's yelling out, you are instructed to cease the yelling so that we can continue with the presentation. I do see Stacey Segura-Bollinger. This is your first formal warning. Everyone else, do not disrupt this meeting or you will be removed.
Gina, thank you for your leadership on this.
Thank you.
Your words have a lot of impact, and it is an honor for me to stand here as an ally with you in the fight against violence.
Thank you so much.
In all its forms against women around the world. I am going to hand the microphone to Nate Looney from the Jewish Federations of North America to offer some remarks.
Esteemed council members, my name is Nate Looney. I'm a native Angeleno and a U.S. Army veteran, and I'm also Jewish. I currently serve as the Director of Community Safety and Belonging at the Jewish Federations of North America. As a man, a transgender man, I recognize my privilege standing before you speaking about matters that primarily impacted and continue to impact women. The horrific attacks of October 7th showed us just how low humanity could go. In a time when being a Jew has falsely become synonymous in some circles with colonialism and whiteness, the true diversity of our Jewish community has been erased. The tapestry that makes this community so dynamic has been cast aside. This unanimous approved resolution speaks volumes. It acknowledges in writing the horrific sexual violence inflicted mostly on women and girls. And let me be clear, rape is never resistance. The overwhelming silence and initial denial from women's rights and human rights organizations was alarming. We all deserve full bodily autonomy. We deserve to feel safe and secure, free from threat of sexual violence, regardless of our skin color or religious affiliation. Today, while we are still grieving the many losses all around, I am hopeful for the future, knowing that this council unanimously approved this resolution, acknowledging the violence against women. This gives me hope for a future of true allyship across differences. My hope is that this resolution will be a launching point for our Los Angeles community to come together. Thank you.
Mr. Looney, thank you so much. The context in which we are here today is a painful reminder of the trauma, that women have experienced as a result of violence and sexual violence, and a reminder to all of us of the work that yet remains to be done. And again, it is my honor to stand in solidarity with you and to present on behalf of the City of Los Angeles this resolution commemorating International Elimination of Violence Against Women's Day. Gina, this is for you. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you so much, Council Member Park. We have a few members on the queue that would like to speak. While you all are taking photographs, we'll begin with Council Member Lee.
Thank you,
folks, please, Mr. Lee, folks, please stop disrupting the meeting. We're keeping track of who's having outbursts. We will remove you from this meeting if it continues. That's your second warning, Ms. Bollinger. You're out.
Ms. Bollinger, you have been warned multiple times, and now you've been instructed to remove this, to exit this meeting, pursuant to Rule 12.
Ms. Bollinger is standing on the chair and will not stop yelling. She's been removed from the meeting and continues to disrupt the meeting. We'll ask the sergeants to remove Ms. Bollinger from the meeting. Ms. Bollinger continues to disrupt the meeting, shouting, standing on the chairs. We'll continue to ask her to leave quietly. All right. Mr. Lee.
Thank you, Councilmember Park, for having these incredible women in here today. I've had the opportunity.
Gentleman who just stood up in the black hoodie, you are instructed not to disrupt this meeting. This is your first and only warning.
Mr. Lee.
I've had the opportunity to work with many of these women in the past and support different causes that they've been a part of. Thank you for highlighting their stories. And you know, this council, I'm hopeful that we'll always stand together to stand against any type of violence against women around the world, and especially here in the city of Los Angeles. You know, we say it over and over, our diversity is our strength here in the city of Los Angeles, and I just appreciate you being here and you bring these women in today to show the impact of their stories and to make sure that everyone hears what they had to say. Thank you, Ms. Park.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Padilla.
So good morning, everyone, and thank you, Councilmember Park, for uplifting this important day of awareness. As many of us know, March is Women's History Month, and it's a time to reflect on and honor the invaluable contributions made by women throughout history. However, in the midst of celebrating these achievements, we must also be real and confront the sober reality of gender-based violence against women as something that happens as well and part of our narrative today. Gender-based violence is a pervasive issue that affects countless individuals worldwide. It is crucial that we continue to provide safe spaces and unwavering support for survivors and continue to have these conversations related to those who have experienced such violence and what we could do to stop it. It's important for all of us, regardless of gender, fellas, to champion policies and programs aimed at preventing violence against women, and to continue working closely with our community and organizations that are already elevating these issues today. You know, one of the major projects that I'm most proud of was actually my time when I was at the county, and I created the Women and Girls Initiative, and we started to be very specific about parameters on how we could create policies step by step, constituency by constituency, women employees, clients of the county, and the contractors of the county. And you know, one of the things that we kept hearing whenever we would discuss how do we stop gender-based violence is that we had to close the gender pay gap, right? It has to do with a lot of women being able to get away from those who are hurting them by making sure that they have the financial means to make it happen. So just in the spirit of Mr. McCosker earlier giving us some homework, I'd like to give everybody some homework too. If you want to learn more about this topic, I highly recommend individuals read the book Half the Sky by Nicholas Kristof and Cheryl Wuban, who show a lot of different case studies on how different things have been done all over the world to improve the status of women and girls, specifically for violence. So thank you again, Councilmember Park, for elevating this. And to everybody who does the good work, let's hope that in this generation, gender isn't something that necessarily dictates how you're treated and what you're paid. Thank you again.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Padilla. Councilmember Rodriguez.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Park, and thank you, ladies, for your advocacy. Sadly, we continue to see women be victims of violence across the world. And unfortunately, in our own country, we've seen how we can't even get basic equal rights. That can't be codified. That has yet to be codified. So as we continue all in a fight, let's make sure that we are in the fight for lifting up all voices in this conversation. It doesn't matter what our history is as women, culturally as women. We have continued to be victimized, persecuted, undervalued, and it's something that we all must continue to be in a fight towards justice and making sure that every voice is valued in these conversations. So I just wanted to thank you for your advocacy. Again, you know, we've seen, you know, we see femicide along the border in Mexico. We've seen, you know, there's a whole host of victims, women facing violence, and we need to fight to protect all women in these conversations. And so I thank you for your advocacy.
Councilmember Hernandez.
Thank you, Council President. Thank you so much, Council Member Park, for uplifting this day. I want to share that I'm a survivor of sexual assault, and so uplifting days like these are really important, and that's why I've dedicated my career to trying to prevent harm and violence instead of just responding to it. And so it's important that we recognize this day, but I also call on my colleagues, my male colleagues who are in this space, the men who are in this room. I want to thank the ones that stand with us when the patriarchy comes after us. And I call on those that haven't stood with us to stand up against the patriarchy when they come after us, because they do every single day. Being a woman politician, man, I can't tell you. The hate that I get just for being a woman and for what I look like is just every day. So thank you for uplifting this and highlighting this. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Yaroslavsky.
Thank you, Councilwoman Park, for bringing this presentation today and shedding light on this important issue. I know for so many of us, the past several months have been incredibly painful as we've watched conflict across the world intensify, knowing full well that women and children are often the ones who bear the brunt of the abuse. And we see it too here at home, where one in three women have experienced rape, physical violence, and/or stalking by an intimate partner in their lifetime. Among unhoused Angelenos, 40% have experienced domestic or intimate partner violence. And I raise that last point particularly because as we hear these horrifying numbers and learn about individual experiences, particularly here at home, and thank you, Councilwoman Hernandez, for speaking your truth today. It's always powerful to hear from people who've experienced violence. We also know that right now the U.S. Congress is considering severe cuts to the Crime Victims Fund, which funds critically needed services for survivors of domestic violence. We can't let that happen. We need to be pushing our leaders in Washington and Sacramento, pushing each other to make sure that we address this issue head on and truly support survivors here and everywhere around the world. So thank you very much.
Councilmember Park.
I just want to say thank you again to each and every one of the individuals that joined us today. It's a proud to be an ally and to stand with you and to all of you in this room who stand with women against violence around the world. Thank you so much. Thank you, Council President.
Thank you so much. All right, Mr. Clerk, can we run through our agenda?
Yes, sir. Items 1 through 55 are items for which public hearings have been held. Items 56 through 69 are items for which public hearings have not been held. Items 70 through 74 are closed session items heard by the Budget, Finance, and Innovation Committee. 10 votes are required for consideration.
Without objection, those items are before us. Do members have any items they wish to call special? Councilmember Hernandez.
President, I would like to call item 16 special for a separate vote, and I have an amendment for item 55. Can the city attorney please read that into the record?
Yes, the motion or the amendment reads that I move that item number 55 on today's council agenda be amended as follows. Instruct the city administrative officer to report to the budget and Finance and Innovation Committee on adding up to $2,992,800 of funding to the Department of the Animal Services Salaries as Needed account in the next financial status report for as-needed relief animal care worker workers and as-needed administrative clerk positions.
All right, is there a second? Second by Mr. McCosker. All right, Mr. McCosker.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I would like to continue item number 26 to April 16th.
All right, without objection.
Thank you very much. And I would also like to pull for comment, call special for comment, item 28 and item 50.
All right, 28 and 50.
Thank you.
All right, Councilmember Yaroslavsky.
Thank you. I'd like to continue item 1 until Tuesday.
Okay.
And I'd like to pull item 54 for brief comments.
All right. Mr. Soto Martinez.
Yes, I'd like to call item 32 special for comments, please, Council President.
All right.
Thank you.
Without objection, Councilmember Rodriguez.
Thank you. I'd like for on item 51, I'd like to recommend that we receive and file the item.
Okay, without objection.
And then for items 70 through 74, we heard these items in Budget and Finance in Innovation Committee, so we can take them up. I recommend we take them.
All right, perfect. Thank you so much for that. And I'll second the note and file, number 51. All right. Any other specials members? Councilmember Rahman.
Could I call item 48 special for remarks? And I have an amendment for item 69, which the city attorney has available.
Yes. So the motion reads that I move that item number 69 on today's council agenda be amended to adopt the recommendations below in lieu of the recommendations in the communication. One, authorize the Housing Department, LAHD, on behalf of the city to apply as the subrecipient of Affordable Housing and Sustainable Communities grant funds for the following projects. A, Alvear Family, $10,981,662. B, the Residences at Crenshaw Crossing, $9,731,241. C, Century Plus Restorative Care Village, PSH, $9,032,400. And two, authorize the general manager of LAHD or designee to sign the attached public agency commitment letters detailing the AHSC Sustainable Transit Infrastructure, STI, and transit-related amenities, TRA, capital projects to be delivered by the city for each proposed project. Three, authorize the Department of Transportation, Bureau of Engineering, and LAHD to prepare and execute the necessary documents required by the AHSC applications, including verification that the STI and TRA capital projects are consistent with all local approval plans and are within the project's right-of-way. And four, direct LAHD to return to council if projects are awarded for any additional actions required to enter into implementation agreements with developer applicants to ensure the city's delivery of the STI and TRA capital project improvements are in accordance with AHSC guidelines.
All right, is there a second? Is there a second? Mr. Soto Martinez seconds. All right, with that, which items are available for us to vote on, Mr. Clerk?
Mr. President, just for the record, I'd like to state that for item 1 has been continued to Tuesday, March 19th.
Okay.
With that, the council may now vote on items 2 through 15, 17 through 25, 27, 29 through 31, 33 through 47, 49, 52 through 54.
All right, those items are before us. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
11 ayes.
All right, what's next?
The council may now vote on item 16 for a separate vote.
All right, item 16 is before us, call special for a separate vote. Let's open the roll, close the roll, Tabulate the vote.
8 ayes, 3 noes.
All right, what's next?
Mr. President, would you like to take up the closed session items 70 through 74?
Yes, let's take those items up. Items 70 through 74, those are now before us.
I will read the settlement into the record. For item 70, in the case entitled Antigua Lumuconda versus the City of Los Angeles, there is a recommendation to expend up to $150,000 in settlement. 71, in the case entitled Savannah Stranger versus the City of Los Angeles et al., there is a recommendation to expend up to $390,000 in settlement. For 72, in the case entitled Terry Webb versus the City of Los Angeles, there is a recommendation to expend up to $750,000 in settlement. 73, in the case entitled Julie Golan versus the City of Los Angeles et al., there is a recommendation to expend up to $990,000 in settlement. 74, in the case entitled Kristen Weldon versus the City of Los Angeles, there is a recommendation to expend up to $5,750,000 in settlement.
All right, those items are before us. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
11 ayes.
All right, what's next?
Mr. President, we could either take the items that were held special for comments, or we can move on to public comment.
Let's take the items that were called special for comments.
I believe we have item 28 for Councilmember McOsker.
All right, Councilmember McOsker.
Thank you very much, members. I will be brief. This is an item that has come through Triple T. What we are doing with this matter is calling upon the port to look into their leasing policy. The port manages many lands that are important to us for the logistics and the world economy, but also for the local economy. And what we are asking the port to do is quite a reasonable request, that before the commission acts on a new lease for a terminal, for example, or extends a terminal or modifies the operation of a terminal, that they look at the impact on jobs. We are not telling them what to do, but we are asking them to know what they indirectly are doing. The applicant would need to analyze what's going to happen with the existing jobs and how will it affect with these new operations or this new lease. Will it increase jobs? Will it decrease jobs? Or will it remain flat? And just as a short case study, just a few years ago, when one of the largest logistics companies on earth was going to be modifying, they called it, automating their terminal, they filled out the application, and when asked what was going to happen to jobs, literally the answer was, we don't know. One of the largest logistics companies on earth that's responsible for moving a pair of sunglasses and does it every single day and makes money doing it, so they're probably good at it, said they did not know what was going to happen to jobs. That was a lie. That was a lie. But shame on us. We didn't call them on it. And we need to have them, under penalty of perjury, tell us what's happening to the jobs when you bring in a new operator, what's happening when you bring in new equipment. And we're not telling you you can't do it. We just need to know. We need to tell us what's going to happen to the jobs? What's going to happen to the local economy? What's going to happen to the dignity of the families that live in that area? And that's all we're asking. It's a simple fix. Commission, port, all you need to do is modify your leasing policy and say, we're going to ask you and we're going to consider it when we lease or modify a new piece of property. Any single one of us would do that if we had a piece of property and we cared about a business. Let's say we owned a piece of commercial property in the middle of the town that we live in. We'd want to know, what are you doing? You laying people off? You hiring more people? What are you selling? What are you doing? We just need to know too. So that's all I'm asking for, and I'd urge an aye vote. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. McOsker. So that item is before us. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
11 ayes.
All right, what's next?
I believe the council has item 32 for Councilmember Soto Martinez.
All right, item number 32, Councilmember Soto Martinez.
Thank you so much, Council President. This vote is about us accepting and approving the city's Child Care Equity Initiative. And I want to just make some brief comments because we had a very extensive report in Civil Rights Committee that I think the public should know and my colleagues should be aware of. But it really underscores the urgency that's happening in the city of Los Angeles. This report highlights a very alarming statistic that families making the average income in Los Angeles are already paying more than one quarter of their salaries for each child in care. We also know that childcare workers are extremely underpaid, overworked, and leads to a massive amount of high turnover. And we're starting to see childcare providers going out of business because of so many different ways the industry has changed, including some of the tax credits that are coming from the state. And we can't forget the folks that are most affected by this is our small children. So I think this really underscores the need to tackle this issue, which also has huge issues of poverty and inequity on multiple fronts. And this report, it gives us a way to address a lot of these issues. But if we do not improve this system, we're going to see many more Angelenos being affected by this, including many folks who simply won't be able to work because they have to take care of their children. And of course, as we've made several comments before, this is one that unfortunately disproportionately affects women, women of color, and of course, folks that are lower bracket on the wage scale. So I want to thank the CIFD department for working diligently on this report and bringing this to us so that we can look at it, read it, and see how we can make our city a little bit more equitable. And of course, I urge an aye vote on this very important issue. Thank you so much.
All right, Councilmember Lee.
Councilmember Soto Martinez, I just want to say thank you for bringing a shining spotlight on this. Affordable daycare has been something, child care has been an issue that's been important to me all my life. When mothers are facing whether they should go to work and spend all that money and time and get that money just to give it then to the daycare, what choice is that? Providing something, a system where we can help those families make that decision where if they do choose to work, that we provide something affordable for them, a safe, obviously, place for them to leave their children. And I just want to thank you for all your work on this and pushing this, because this is something that I think we all should understand that should be something available to Angelenos, and just appreciate it. And I urge your aye vote on this.
Thank you so much, Mr. Lee. Seeing no other speakers, this item is before us. Let's open the roll. Close the roll, tabulate the vote.
11 ayes.
All right, what's next?
Council has item 48 for Councilmember Rahman.
All right, number 48 is before us, Councilmember Rahman.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Council President, for allowing me the chance to speak briefly on this. This item is related to the Ventura specific plan, which was written quite a long time ago, and through it created a plan review board which governed many of the issues that come up along the coverage area of the specific plan. That plan review board used to have appointees from all of the relevant council districts in that area, along with one at-large member. There was also no real notification process for some of the administrative issues that resulted from the plan, including letting members know when their terms expired. These administrative issues were further underscored after the 2021 redistricting process, when two of the four original council districts in the specific plan area were no longer within that area. So today's motion and set of recommendations essentially fixes what resulted from that redistricting process, ensures that every neighborhood covered by the Ventura specific plan area has representation on the council, provides administrative guidance for members to ensure that they're notified of any status changes to their terms and other issues, and allows for council districts to also have a say. And I want to thank Councilmember Blumenfield, who is my partner in putting this motion forward, as well as Councilmember Harris Dawson for allowing us to make some adjustments in the Plum Committee. And I encourage everyone's aye vote on making these adjustments today and allowing for development along the Ventura Boulevard corridor, one of the most exciting places in the city, to happen.
without any further delays or issues to all the vibrant businesses that are set up there. Thank you.
Thank you so much. All right, this item is before us. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
11 ayes.
All right, what's next?
The council may now vote on items 51 and 55 as amended. Those amendments were introduced and circulated.
All right, those items are before us. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
11 ayes.
All right, I believe that takes us to public comment.
That's correct, sir.
All right, we will begin public comment by hearing instructions from the clerk as well as guidelines from the Los Angeles City Attorney.
As indicated on the agenda, members of the public wishing to offer public comments should call 669-254-5252 and use meeting ID number 160-535-8466 and then press pound. Then press pound again when prompted for participant ID. Once admitted into the meeting, press star 9 to request to speak. When it is your turn to speak, an automated Zoom voice will ask you to press star 6 to unmute. Let me repeat, call 669-254-5252 and use meeting ID number 160-535-8466, and then press pound. Then press pound again when prompted for participant ID. Once admitted into the meeting, press star 9 to request to speak. When it is your turn to speak, an automated Zoom voice will ask you to press star 6 to unmute.
To people providing public comment, when it is your turn to speak, either at the podium or on the phone, please state which of the agenda items you would like to speak to. You will have 1 minute per item, up to 3 minutes total, for the items open for public comment. We will tell you when your time is up. When speaking on the agenda items, you must be on topic. Our goal is to get through as many speakers as we can. If you are not on topic, or if we cannot tell whether you are speaking on topic, you will get one brief warning from me or the president. At that point, you need to get immediately and clearly on topic. If you do not do so, or if you again stray off topic, you will forfeit the rest of your speaking time and we will move on to the next speaker. The items open for public comment are 56 through 69. I'll repeat, again, the items that are open for public comment on the agenda are items 56 through 69. For members of the public who would like to give general public comment, you may also speak for up to 1 minute, which in general public comment will be held at the end of this meeting. Members of the public may also speak to any of the other items or anything else in the city's subject matter jurisdiction during general public comment. For members of the public calling in, when it is your turn to speak, an automated message from Zoom will prompt you to press star 6 to unmute yourself. If you do not do so, council staff will prompt you once more. At that point, you need to immediately unmute yourself, or unfortunately, you will forfeit your time and we will have to move on to the next caller. Finally, because of a brief time delay between the live meeting and the broadcast, two things are important. First, while waiting for your turn to speak, please keep an ear to the phone so you know in real time when it is your turn to press star 6 to unmute. Second, if you're listening to this meeting on another device, please turn down the volume on that device immediately when it is your turn to speak. Between the time delay and feedback, it will cause a great deal of confusion if you continue to listen on your other devices. Thank you.
All right, we'll begin. You'll hear your name called. We'll ask you to come up in any order. Once your name is called, you'll have a minute for each item that you want to speak on, up to 2 minutes.
Grabner, Candido, Can, Adam Smith, Goat Puppet, Jamie F., Danielle.
Good morning. Which items would you like to speak to?
All items and general comment.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items. Please begin.
All right, so let's start off with item 57. Item 57 is related to lighting up City Hall for the International Women's Day on March 8th, which was a week ago. So, you know, I wonder what the amount the city is going to pay in debt for paying it late. What's the interest on that? Because, you know, poor people, you charge them interest, you charge them penalty fees, late fees if they pay things late. Or in some cases, you just have the cops come and arrest them and, you know, for paying something late. But here you are paying this a week late. So there's got to be some kind of interest or penalty for you paying it late. Let's see. We have item 59. That's a motion from Kikorian for his Earth Day LA celebration. Kikorian, who's taking a vacation because he doesn't want people yelling at him for his ethics violations. Kikorian's holding it at the North Hollywood Conveyance Yard, the sewage maintenance facility, which sums up his council presidency pretty well. You know, I wonder if during this event, if Paul is going to endorse someone for city council using his official position as a council member and council president during this official city event. I wonder if that's going to happen or not. Let's see. We have item 65. That's for Denim Day. Lighting up City Hall for Denim Day related to the sexual assault she talked a little bit about earlier. Or no, actually you didn't. You just spent an hour being pro-genocide and lying about what's going on in Gaza. And you should all call for a ceasefire.
Please connect it to the agenda.
Related about sexual assault. And you know, you talk about violence. What about when physical and sexual violence against women? What about when the cops have physically assaulted women in City Hall? Many of them are in this chamber right now, or at least in this building. We have 68. That's related to the Primetime Emmy Awards. Hopefully, no one house people are going to be subject to a sweep because of that. You might get more information. We might be able to get more information on that kind of thing if you'd release the report back on 4118.
Next speaker.
Good morning.
Good morning. Which items would you like to speak to?
Number 57 and 58.
Okay, so you have 2 minutes for the items. Please begin.
Great. My name is Adam Smith. I'm from the Los Angeles Community Action Network's Human and Civil Rights Committee. I think there's a lot that comes out of this room and still doesn't come out of this room. But, you know, I appreciate celebrations of Women's Day and mental health awareness. But I think that sometimes these things ring a little hollow when we see a lot of the violence against unhoused people and women around the city. Yesterday, while I was observing an encampment sweep on Gladys in Skid Row, a woman's tent was knifed by sanitation. A nice tent was knifed by sanitation, and then Narcan and menstrual pads were taken out of that tent, and all of that stuff was trashed. And so I guess I'm just like not trying to hijack these agenda items, but when we talk about Women's Day and when we talk about women's rights and we talk about mental health awareness, and we're still waiting for the city's accountability on this 4118 report back, which I may have been here before speaking about, and that might not be on topic for I Am Groat, but it is on topic when you're out observing the violence of these sweeps, the violence of the LAPD reset team using 4118 to target women, to pull them out and run them for probation and parole checks and arrest them on old warrants for shit that they can't afford to pay. Like, this stuff keeps happening. And this is why we're continuing to ask for this report back and asking council members to actually lift up our demand for this report back. Like, there's so much silence in this room around this ongoing 4118 enforcement while we're waiting like a year for this report back. Thank you.
Good morning. If you could please remind us of the name you signed up under and the items you would like to speak to.
Shamika, and I'm speaking to numbers 57 and 58.
I'm sorry, can you please pull the microphone a little closer?
Shamika, and I'm speaking to items 57 and 58.
Okay, so you have 2 minutes for the items. Please begin.
So these celebrations, they're great, you know. I'm a woman, Women's Day, and all of that. But it's funny how we're celebrating that while we're still being hurt by this 4118. We are just asking for the report. I'm an unhoused woman, and we're constantly harassed. We're constantly being swept under the rug. All we're asking for is a report. Can we get the report back on 4118? We're suffering with mental health, with being harassed, with our rights being diminished, all of that. So I'm just here to say that we are looking for the report back on 4118. It's 277 days overdue. That's ridiculous. We're asking for the report back. Thank you.
Good morning. If you could please remind us of the name you signed up under and the items you would like to speak to.
I'm Jamie, and I want to speak on 57 and 58, but I'm going to start with 58, actually.
Okay, so you have 2 minutes for the items.
Okay, thank you. I'm a constituent of CD5, and on the topic of Mental Health Month, I want to address 4118. This continues to displace folks whose belongings are stolen by the city, including medication for anxiety and depression. The increased arrests and presence and violence inflicted by LAPD is traumatic and damaging to unhoused folks' mental health. I've seen in the face of 4118 in my neighborhood again and again that it's made it harder for my neighbors to get closer to accessing permanent supportive housing. As we've seen from the recently leaked report, 4118 is not effectively offering housing, which is critical to people's well-being. Please abolish 4118, look at this report, look at how it's ineffective, release the report, and invest in direct resources for housing, mental health services, and substance use abuse treatment. On 57, these justifications for genocide continue to become more ludicrous. I'm disgusted. A presentation for International Women's Day that Zionism is being weaponized against me as a Jewish woman. The IDF, who also happens to train the LAPD, perpetuates violence against women and children and women and mothers in Palestine. Where is the mention of Palestinian women and children who are dying of starvation? Is everyone going to stay silent as $14 billion in the works to be sent to continue this occupation and violence while six people a day die in the streets of Los Angeles? Stop wasting resources on 4118. Direct them to folks living on the street who are not getting services and are also victims and survivors of domestic violence and sexual assault. Do not use my faith, my gender against me in the name of genocide. Free Palestine.
Good morning. If you could please remind us of the name you signed up under and the items you would like to speak to.
Yes. Danielle, I'm going to speak to 58 and 57.
Okay. So you have 1 minute for the item.
For both items, 58 and 57.
You have 2 minutes.
Thank you. Begin. With Mental Health Month coming up, as a CD5 constituent, I'm extremely concerned about how 4118 will be used to displace my neighbors who are houseless. While we are still 277 days overdue on CD5's report back on 4118, instead of investing in permanent housing and supportive resources, we are causing policies that are detrimental to people's mental health. I'm sick and tired of council prioritizing policies that are disappearing houselessness, that center disappearing houselessness while I watch friends be chased block by block and lose their belongings in sweeps like IDs and medication, including medication for anxiety and depression. I urge council to abolish 4118 and to invest in permanent housing and supportive resources. On item 57, I'm a Jewish woman who denounces the occupation, Zionism, and Israel's apartheid state. Are we really going to discuss Women's History Month and not speak about Palestinian women and children? Palestinian people and children are dying of starvation right now. 2 out of every 6 children in Gaza are malnourished. 31,000 people are dead at the hands of the Israeli government. Our tax dollars are funding this. Not in my name as a Jewish woman will my faith be used to justify genocide. Never again means now. As a Jewish woman, I say permanent ceasefire now. Is anyone going to say anything about the fact that Congress...
What topic is this on?
International Women's Day. I'm a Jewish woman, and I'm speaking on the fact that I don't want Zionism being equated with International Women's History Month. Is anyone going to say anything about the fact that Congress is about to send $14.1 billion to the Israeli military, $0 in humanitarian aid, while 6 people are dying each day on the streets of Los Angeles? I want to see a permanent and immediate ceasefire now.
Now it's time for gangsters to speak. Well, go ahead.
Good morning. You have 3 minutes for the items.
Yes, Irish pumpkin head. So, let's see here. Look at the nice stealing on 69. You've got, let's see, Heather Jabba the Hutt, Paul Martin Krikorian, the goat herder, and Kevin DeLeon. Oh, Kevin, now you're stealing on number 69. You're breaking my heart. We don't know where these projects are. We don't know anything. Am I going to have to listen to Unisys and vote for Isabel? Now, don't make me do that. I want to know what's on this agenda. Where are these projects? Stop proving Unisys correct. I want her to be wrong. I want to come back to your side, but you're forcing me into a bad hand here, my friend. I think Kevin's fucking up. He's fucking up bad. Now we get to, let's see here, the Academy of Assholes. Let's see, what do we got here? The Asshole Technical Association of Scumbags, the ATAS, is holding their 75th Primetime Emmy Awards. Well, first of all, nobody watches TV anymore. Number one, it's boring. And number two, you can just go on YouTube and get it all for free with no commercials. $110,000 payment to CD9. Why are we paying an indicted felon, CD9, $110,000? Shame on you, Marchese. You know better than that. He's going to be going to prison before the end of the year. I move that this money be split between CD1 and CD8, where it's really needed. I second that. Well done. Thank you. Now we get to some other shit. Let's see here. CD 12, number 64, fuck number 64. 65, fuck number 65. I don't want to illuminate City Hall. I want to turn the lights off and put you out of business. That's what I want. And then we get to CD 7. You're doing a good job, Moni Cow. I'm going to give you a shout out on number, what is it? 66. 66 is an excellent job. I want more council members to do it. Here's a shout out to CD7. Moo! A shout out to Moni Cow. Good job. Keep eating. And then we have number 67, a dedicated requirement for Marchese. That's right. Now he's not going to pay attention. That's right. What do we call that? Plausible deniability. That's right. So that he could tell the FBI later he wasn't paying attention when he voted yes. I'll be back on general comment to tell the Irish to go fuck themselves. Stay tuned.
Next speaker.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Items 57, 58, and 66, if okay. I may.
So you have 3 minutes for the items. Please
thank
begin.
You, sir. 57 is honoring women. You know, when you were honoring Mr. Commissioner DeFank, I was looking at his wife, and that's the person I wanted to honor, because you could see on her face, as much as he loved what he was doing, that poor woman suffered all those years and had to go through so much mental, probably illness, because of what he was doing and her fear of what's going to happen to him. And again, I want to honor Mrs. DeFrank because she's the true hero there. As far as mental illness, you know, 4118, folks, you said you would bring that before the council for a full vote, and we're still waiting for that. Over and over again, we're hearing about the mistreatment of the homeless. And as you know, I'm not a big supporter of all the things that we're doing for them, but 4118 is something that I feel that we need to bring forward. 66 is about the copper that's been stole from 7, but I want to bring something else. If we look at all the departments, copper is so expensive. Take a look at water and power. Look at street service. Look at all these departments. Take a look at their inventory, and let's ask how much of that inventory has been stolen from our departments. Department of Water and Power over off of Oxnard had a huge amount of copper parts that were there. I wonder if they're still there, Mr. President. That money could have been used for other purposes. So again, let's make sure not only are we protecting our lights, but let's make sure that within our departments, the copper is not being stolen. Because if I stole one piece, like the old Johnny Cash story about him building a Cadillac, I could steal one part every day. I can have myself a heck of a little profit there. Thank you.
Good morning. If you could please remind us of the name you signed up under and the items you would like to speak to.
Good morning. My name is Eric Sheehan. I'm with No Olympics LA. I'd like to speak on 57 and 58.
Okay, so you have 2 minutes.
So 57, the way y'all are using Women's Day to support genocide is pretty wild, but not a huge surprise. White women have a long history of involvement in criminalizing black and brown folks, so good on you for continuing that. On 58, I'd like to speak both in support and opposition of this celebration of Mental Health Month. We critically need to support folks dealing with mental health crises, but lighting up City Hall is simply not enough. You know what can cause a mental health crisis? Living in a city where your very existence is criminalized. Living in a street where your medication and legal documents can be taken and thrown away by police because you put your tent in a 4118 zone. Living in a place where you don't have access to clean bathrooms. How many bathrooms does Skid Row have? Having a safe place to shit is important to my mental health. I think it's important to yours too. Unhoused people are less likely to instigate violent attacks than housed people. Most police use of force is used against homeless folks. If we're gonna light up City Hall to pat ourselves on the back, we should probably stop contributing to people's mental health crises by criminalizing their very existence. Release the report so we can address this failure and support the mental health of Angelenos. Where is the report?
Richard Serrano, 66, 57, and 58.
Okay, so you'll have 3 minutes for the items. Please begin.
57, you have a lot of ladies here celebrating National Ladies Day, but not one of you here is paying attention. Not one of you, not even the ladies. They're all on their phones texting. They're coming out here and pleading to you. Listen to them. There's a reason this day exists. I'm sorry, but you guys are falling short. You do not represent the people that elected you, but you did when you were running for office, right? Put your phones down, listen to these ladies. It's not easy for them to come out here and say something.
This is not on the agenda. I need you to tie it to the agenda items, please.
I got 15 seconds left on that item. Sorry, Mr. City Attorney. That let Mr. the Jesus Paul Kerkorian voted on as a landlord last week, and I pointed it out to you. Do you represent the city or Paul Kerkorian?
Speaker, which item are you speaking to? I can't tell.
I want you guys to pay attention to the people that come out and cry to you.
This is your only warning. You are not on the agenda.
Let's go to 57.
You need to stick to the agenda items.
57, or let's go to 58. Mental health, maybe you'll understand this one. It's not easy for people to come out here and pour out their hearts to counsel people that only are there for you when you want to get elected. If not, you're on a phone or in the back rooms. Please pay attention to the people that are coming out here. It's
Speaker,
still on
this
item.
This is your final warning. This is not on the agenda item. So this is your final warning. Then please connect it to the items.
Again, it's not easy for them to come out here and speak to you if you're not paying attention. Mr. City Attorney, maybe you fall suit. Number 66, the copper wire being stolen. 2017, I caught somebody stealing that on my off day. LAPD arrested them. I got a commendation, but that's what we're supposed to do, get involved. We're supposed to represent while we're on the clock or off the clock. And since you're on the clock, please pay attention to this chamber.
Maria Zuba, Benkoy Matakoy, Eric, Adam Smith, Daniel Dickerson, Catlago, Angela L., Ashley Lavaya, Bonnie, Cameron Christensen, Carolina Adler.
Good morning. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you'd
Catlago, like to speak on. I would like to speak on items 68, 69, and 58, mental health.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items. Please begin.
58. Is that y'all got all this money for everybody else though. 4118 is criminalizing the homeless though. Y'all need to be housing the homeless instead of getting sending all this money to Israel and Ukraine. Because that and also I'm gonna speak on 68 about this Peacock Theater that's in downtown near the convention center. Marquise Heron Dawson wasted $110,000 off of taxpayer dollars. He could be taking that shit to house the homeless in his district. His district has one of the most highest homeless on black unemployment rate in the city. Show you number of corruption. You want to do the damn theater instead of housing the people in his community, his district.
So, Speaker, item 68 is about the Emmys Award. So, please.
That's what I'm doing. Reference to that. Our taxpayers going towards that shit. I don't want my taxpayers going to tax dollars going to that shit. Then I'm going to speak on 69 about the housing. Karen's Bass Safe Initiative Program. What the hell is that shit going to? She only housed less than 200 people. Where's all the other rest of the money going to? That shit ain't going towards community or going towards housing the homeless people. That shit is stuff in your pockets and shit. Then I'm going to speak on that about the Jewish incident and about the women's rights shit is that y'all send the money to all these other countries and shit, Israel, Ukraine, and the Holocaust didn't even happen in America. The Holocaust happened in Germany. That means Germany should take that responsibility on that burden. And y'all and the black community don't support genocide, what's going on in Palestine too. Y'all had that puppet and that clown up there trying to see the black community support that shit. The black community don't support genocide was going on. So, yeah, free Palestine, stop gentrification. Israel, Israeli government's race towards the black community too. They don't like black people and shit. The Israeli government said that the biggest threat to black, the Israeli is the black community
so,
in America.
Speaker,
so,
I cannot tell which
we just let y'all know that the black community do not support Israel. We do not support genocide against Palestine.
Items.
That's all I got to say.
Next speaker. Good morning. If you could please remind us of the name you signed up under and the items you would like to speak to.
Good morning. My name is Bonnie, and I was going to speak on 55, but since that is not something that's up there, I'm actually only going to speak a general public comment. I know you wanted to do that at the end.
Yes, so.
But I think mostly everybody waiting is now for general public comment. Can
understood.
We start that?
So we're not taking general public comment at this time. So members of the public, please do not disrupt this meeting. So general public comment will be later on in the meeting, so I apologize. But
okay.
We're only sticking to the agenda items right now. So is there anyone who would like to speak on the open agenda items? Again, that's items number 56 through 69, who has not already been given the opportunity to speak. Good morning. Which items would you like to speak to?
Good morning, sir. because my language disability, I would like to speak on all items, please.
So you have 3 minutes for the items. Please begin.
Yup, yo, sub guy, see sub, gap pain, button jab, sub, yagon, mega gap, sub, yup, tongue, sub, get, forgot, this is 57. Mega gap, sue your tongue, sue, gap, gap, sell, gap, by look, guy, yup, yahom, teen do hum, yum, binking, so die, buck a two, son, fob, di die, lobby, deal, song, di, buck and sell, yo, yup, yes, a yun, do, yasu, gale, you, you in the bean, guan, chin, su, gay, gag, one, most of sung, sin, di, do, yo, hum, mo, sue, son, mung, yun, you, you, ting, two, boy, lay, boy, chong, sin, ju, sin, da, zol, din, co, one, sin, da, die, lung, wong, jun, mung, yun, die, di, teen, chis, wait, and so, gang, chis, you, see, lay, see, zo, yo, chin, yi, jerry, for, sin, ting, or, yu, ting, ho, yo, chi, chi, do, so, yu, gong, lai, yu, ting, bog, and, cho, yu, yun, yi, fo, sai, chi, ting, yu, zo, yu, king, 故有所闻当遇至从事也复可也是从圣山最高中寸动雷锋打书身受旨诸句尽力而不止至少四肢坚坚不能动非人之汤壮矣
Now, allow me to switch to number
58
Now let's talking about the copper wire agenda, whatever that might be the copper wire. It is a lot of stolen copper wire property in the city. And then that is, like I mentioned many times, not only the copper wire, but literally any store, any property, any citywide small business, private residence, copper wire, Department of Public Works, you know, whatever. Because there's no crime, there's no consequence of committing crime, so we are seeing more copper wire crime. Because there's no consequence for doing something wrong inside of the city of LA, because we have a woke liberal policy for not for promoting crime, promoting those wrongdoings, that's the reason why we are seeing a high rise of copper wire. But at the same time, not only copper wire, but everything small, terrible crime will continue to increase.
Speaker, your time has expired. Next speaker.
Harriet Elliott, Joey Tichio, Judy Guzman, Michael Perry, Prenel Stanfield, Susan Collins, Valerie Victoria.
I'm Harriet Elliott.
Good morning.
I don't
which
know
items
why
would
I'm given 3 minutes, but
which items would you like to speak
60.
To?
Okay. I'm saying that my council member in 10 is wanting to take money out of redevelopment and put it into this track and field. Excellent idea. She has some very down-to-earth beliefs. Spindler said 2 weeks ago that all of you council members who are Democrats, progressives, are fawning over Michael Moore when he retired. And I didn't see my council member do that. I'm so glad. And I'm wondering if she doesn't have black women in her district whose kids have been killed, like my kid was killed. Well, and that's why she can't find it in herself to fawn over Michael Moore. I'm police chief. My son died in 92. And I actually believe that Bratton at the time knew exactly what they were doing. They killed my son.
Good morning. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak to.
Yes, my name is Susan Collins, and I'd like to speak on all available items.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items, and again, that's items 56 through 69. Please begin.
Thank you. I'm here today to draw attention to the deplorable, inhumane conditions animals endure at the hands of the agencies you oversee. But my comments here are really more for the people in attendance, because they are kind, compassionate, caring people who foolishly believed that the same people who have knowingly cultivated the identical, deplorable, inhumane living conditions resulting in thousands of deaths every year for the people of Los Angeles would somehow do better for animals. With a few exceptions, the members of this council and the mayor are liars, cheats, and frauds,
I'm sorry,
and you
Speaker,
all know it.
The animal services item is number 55 and is not currently open for public comment. So I need you to speak to an item that's open for public comment.
Okay, thank you. You are not in office by the will of the people, but by ballot harvesting and cheating the system. At this point, you're also guilty of depraved indifference to life. My message to everyone in attendance is if you want better for animals, the only way we'll get
so
it
again,
is by forcing
Speaker,
change
is
in our
final
election
warning.
Process.
I need you to tie so this to an agenda item or you're going to forfeit your time.
Right, so that our votes actually matter. And my message to the council members and the mayor is shame on you. Thank you.
If anybody would like to speak on the agenda items, now's the time to come up. Remember, public comment is being taken at the end of the meeting. If you have a public, if you have agenda item to come and speak.
So, please do not yell out during this meeting. Item number 55 is not open for public comment. It was heard at committee. So is there anyone else who would like to speak on the agenda items that are open for public comment? That's item 56 through 69. Okay, Mr. Candido, please do not interrupt this meeting.
Okay, can we move to the phones now for agenda items?
And for people calling in, again, the items that are open for public comment are 56 through 69.
Caller ending in 8130, please press star 6 to unmute.
What's up, nerds and virgins? Brock Landers, Los Angeles private investigator. All public items.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items. Please begin.
All right, 68, the great panderer. Hopefully they give you a front row seat. The way you pander, you could teach their lame riders a thing or two. Maybe you can talk someone into giving smoke and scan a TV show. 58, where were you women talking about the women in Palestine in September? And for International Women's Day, Damon is looking for someone to do help out with the shirt laundry, if anybody wants to volunteer. And on Women's Month, stop talking about how you need men to stand with you. You guys have jobs. Buy tickets and support the WNBA games. The reason no one goes is not on the men. It's you need to support your own people. And 69. Brock Lander, 69, says, make her come first and come hard the first time. She'll keep coming back to more. You can put me on hold for general public comment.
Next caller.
Caller ending in 0463, please press star 6 to unmute.
Good morning, elite communist war pig.
Good morning. Which items would you like to speak to?
I would like to speak to illuminating the building. I don't know what item number that is. Good morning, Smoke and Scan. Damon, you're the man.
Speaker, this is your last opportunity to speak. I need you to identify the items that you'd like to speak to.
I believe it's 56, the illuminating of the building. Is that correct?
Sorry, the illumination of City Hall. So that would be items 57 or 58.
Okay, 57, 58. So I have a great alternative. We need to bring back armed Korean dads on rooftops, bitch.
Speaker, this is your only warning. This is not on the agenda. So please stick to the agenda items or you will forfeit your speaking time.
And I think there was one about the copper. Okay. And I think I'll go to public comment. Thank you.
So next caller.
Caller ending in 1991, please press star 6 to unmute. Caller, please press star 6 to unmute. Caller ending in 1991, please press star 6 to unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay.
Good afternoon. Which items would you like to speak to?
I'll speak to the public on 56, items 56, 67, 68, and protesting the Brown Act violations.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items. Please begin.
Item 56, thank you. I'm in agreement with this grant from the Department of Aging, as this corrupt city council should exercise more expenditures of the people's funds on the aging versus the criminal self-serving looting activities of Kern Price and Marquise Dawson. 67, this public right-of-way waiver requirement is another self-serving act by criminal Marquise Dawson for this park because I believe he is receiving under-the-table funds and personal benefit from this project. I am opposed to this project and sleazy Marquise Dawson spending his time on a personal benefit park when 33% of all female assaults are against black women. I demand a no vote if indicted Kern Price and unelected puppet Heather Hutt are allowed to vote on this item. 68, by indicted criminal Kern Price is for city services in the amount of $110,000 for some stupid Emmy Awards. When 3 to 8 of the 60,000 homeless people on the streets of Los Angeles will die today, this Emmy Award funding proposal to go to a billion-dollar industry by this criminal and criminally Marquise Dawson is the typical representation given to the black community. I demand a no vote and not one penny of the public's money to go toward the type of crap when the people in Price and Dawson's district areas are starving to death on the street. This item should receive a no vote if indicted criminal Kern Price is allowed to vote. This item should receive a no vote if illegitimate, unelected Heather Hutt is allowed to vote. I'd like to do public comment also, general public comment, later.
Next caller.
Caller ending in 9809, please press star 6 to unmute.
Yeah, hi. DanielGus.substack.com.
Good afternoon.
All
which items?
Okay,
so you have 3 minutes for the items, Mr. Gus.
Great, and then I'm going to come back for general public comment, so don't cut me off. Item number 57, Women's Month. This is interesting. I will remind City Council that 1 year ago, I reported exclusively, because the LA Times didn't, that you have a domestic violence situation at the top of the LA Fire Department where one of your command staffers, Kristen Katie Kepner, was on video threatening homicide against her domestic partner who was a female. So where were you then, council members, on International Women's Day? Where have you been for the past year on International Women's Day when you have domestic violence, women on women, at the top of the LA Fire Department? And by the way, talk about women standing up for women, council members. Kristen Crowley, the chief of the fire department, celebrated Women's Day with you. And she had a video of the homicidal
suicidal threat. So, Mr. Gus, please move on to another item.
Sure. Item 58. Perfect thing. Mental health awareness. How can you have a top brass of the fire department threatening murder-suicide? Threatening murder-suicide against your domestic partner, and you're here to promote Women's Mental Health Day or Mental Health Week or month? You have a suicidal threatening homicidal threatening person who's at a heartbeat away from the being chief of the LA Fire Department. So how dare you talk about mental health when you have a recorded evidence that, by the way, Michael Moore had in his possession too. You have mental health dangers at the top of the fire department. How dare you talk about mental health when your chief of police and your chief of the fire department have one of your own threatening murder, suicide.
So, well, Mr. Gus, please move on to another item. You've exhausted your 1 minute.
Okay. Item number 65, Denim Day, about sexual assault. In the same case, how dare you promote, against sexual violence when the chief of your fire, the brass of your fire department, Kristen Katie Kepner, was on video, not just threatening murder-suicide, but apparently the assault, which was recorded, included a sexual assault against her domestic partner, who was a woman. So it's all hypocrisy, 57, 58, 65. And Ms. Kepner, if you want to sue me for defamation, I got a copy of the video. You're hypocrites by not protecting women, but claiming you're protecting women, claiming you want to help with mental health, and right at the top of the fire department, $400,000 a year.
Mr. Gus, your time has expired. Next caller.
Caller ending in 4208, please press *6 to unmute.
Good afternoon, Groat. It's Rob.
Good afternoon.
To speak on items.
Which items would you like to speak to?
58 and 59.
Okay, so you have 2 minutes for the items. Please begin.
Three minutes. I got 57, 58, 59.
So 3 minutes for the items, yes.
And thank you. For mental health, my mental health and that of hundreds of others was impacted today by City Council arbitrarily saying that the chambers were at capacity and making us wait outside. Our government wants to tell us that COVID is over. If you catch it and you have a cup of chicken noodle soup, you can go back to work the next day. But this council wants to maintain a years old limit on capacity. Instead of having us wait inside like we used to, you make us wait outside. It's just absurd. And I hope all of these animal rights activists who turned out strong today realize how this council has rigged the rules to arbitrarily silence them. By sticking general public comment at the end, they ensure that this room stays at capacity and 100 people will be unable to have their voices heard here. Just disgraceful. And on the note of mental health, my mental health would be a lot better if we hadn't had 4 council members arrested in the last 4 years. My mental health would be a lot better if this council had done a single thing to change a single law to address corruption since 2019. But they haven't, and they haven't done a single thing over this last year and a half since the Fed tapes to do a fucking thing. That really messes with my mental health. For 59, I don't think we should be voting on this. Paul Kerkorian ain't here. He's been off on France, Japan, missing the last few meetings, refused to hold himself accountable for his misuse of city resources for political activity. He needs to repent or resign. And on the note of International Women's Day, it's important to recognize that for nearly half of the last decade, we only had one woman on this council. With Councilmember Rahman's win and KDL's likely demise, we will now have a majority of women on council. This didn't happen by accident. It happened because council stepped up, unlike this council. A decade ago, we had a study that revealed women won council races at the same rate men did, but only made up 20% of the candidates. With our move to high turnout elections and matching funds reform, we have actual change. Councilmember Rahman's election inspired candidates like Ulysses, but it also served for inspiration for somebody like Tracy Park, who could believe that she could take on an incumbent or even an establishment candidate like Greg Good. Now, Paul Kerkorian hasn't done shit to lift up women in his time. In fact, during redistricting, he was in the blender with Rahman, and he flipped and worked with Nuri so he could save himself all for a dream Nazarian. Just like we saw last week with his misuse of city position. And he used his city office to pump up Nazarian's candidacy against one of those young women that was inspired to run. Absolutely shameful stuff. I don't want to hear shit from y'all talking about Women's Day until you do something to uplift women and give them a better opportunity to represent this country.
Mr. Kwan, your time has expired.
Mr. Clerk, now that we've closed public comment on the agenda items, I'd like to reconsider item number one, if we can put that up for a vote. Open the roll. Close the vote. Tabulate the vote.
12 ayes.
All right, can we take up that item number one again? Open the roll on that item. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
12 ayes.
All right. Mr. Clerk, what other items can we council vote on?
Mr. President, the council may now vote on items 56 through 68.
All right. Mr. Clerk, can you please open the roll on those items? Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
12 ayes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Clerk. Can we move on to the items that the members called special for discussion?
I believe Councilmember Soto Martinez.
Hello, Council President. I'd like to send item 56 forthwith, please.
Without objection, that should be the order.
The council may now move on to item 54, comments by Councilmember Yaroslavsky.
All right, item number 54. Let's take item number 54. Councilmember Yaroslavsky, would you like to?
Colleagues, I rise today to ask for your aye vote. This motion calls for better coordination of city departments in executing first last mile planning, design, and construction. As our regional bus and light rail systems continue to expand, and as we prepare for implementation of Measure HLA, we need to be breaking down bureaucratic silos that have really slowed our efforts to create robust and efficient public transportation system in Los Angeles. Being intentional about active transportation is a really critical piece of that effort. We've built out, or we're building out, our metro infrastructure. That's great. But that way people access those stations is just as important as the rail lines themselves. So this motion ensures that we're not just sending money that we're obligated to spend to Metro, but we're actually thoughtfully planning and building local investments that best meet the needs of our communities. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilmember Yaroslavsky. Mr. Clerk, can we please open the roll on this item? Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
12 ayes.
All right.
The council may move on to item 50, called special by Councilmember McOsker.
All right, Councilmember McOsker.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, members. Item 50 is what I consider to be a fix in our land use policies throughout the city. We all have a number of great community gardens that are in our communities, and community gardens are in residential neighborhoods in virtually every zoning designation in the city. Probably unintentionally, there is a current interpretation that would prohibit folks from raising food, growing food in the local community, and then having the ability to distribute or sell it right there in that local community. And in order to fix that, what I'll call a miss, or maybe even an inequity, because a number of our communities that are grocery poor or are food deserts have these beautiful gardens that are typically served, cared for, nurtured by some of our immigrant communities and some of our underrepresented communities. That's particularly true in the 1-5, and I'm sure that's true in your districts. What this would do is direct the city attorney, working with planning, to come back with a very fair and measured ordinance that would allow for limited periods of time and on occasion, and the suggestion here is every other week, for a set number of hours, that those community gardens could do on-site sales to their communities. In my neighborhood, there is such a garden, and there was a period of time where they were doing those sales, and they were actually shut down. But it was lovely, because folks, before church, after church, on their way to their events on Saturday, could swing by the community garden, could meet with the folks that were actually growing these foods, and could purchase healthy foods that are grown right in sight of our own house. And that's the case throughout all of our communities, from Watts to the water. And I'm sure that's the case for you. So I would urge an aye vote, and I look forward to the city attorney coming back. Oh, and we do have some neighbors. We do have some neighbors from the 1-5 here. Just raise your hands and say hello, who are really, really eager. I mean, these are great folks who have a lot of challenges. Water is expensive. The disposing of our trash is expensive, our organic system is expensive, and this is just one break that some really good folks that are nurturing our neighborhoods and serving our neighborhoods and feeding our neighborhoods need. So I would call for an aye vote. Thank you.
Mr. Rodriguez. Councilman Rodriguez, you wish to speak on this item?
No, I'm sorry, not on this item. I just wanted to, I'll wait till after this item.
All right. Seeing no other comments, Mr. Clerk, can you please call the roll on this item? Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
11 ayes.
Councilman Rodriguez.
Thank you. I'd like to request that we send item 16 forthwith and item 29A to committee.
Without objection, that'd be the order. Mr. McCosker?
Could I ask that item 41 be sent forthwith? Thank you.
Without objection, that'd be the order. Mr. Clerk, can we move to item number 69? Mr. De Leon, I believe you have an amendment to this item.
That is correct. City Attorney has the amendments.
Yes, so the amendment reads that I move that item 69 on today's council agenda be amended to adopt the following additional recommendation. 5, instruct the Housing Department in coordination with other relevant departments to report on any administrative and financial impacts caused by the change in the application process with the developer as an applicant and the city as a subrecipient.
Mr. Price?
Thank you, Mr. President. Out of an abundance of caution, I need to recuse myself from this item due to the lack of information about who is working on the specific projects.
All right, let's take Mr. Price off the board. All right, at this time, we're going to vote on 69, Amendment 69B. Mr. Clerk, open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
10 ayes.
All right, let's move on to 69A. Mr. Clerk, open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
10 ayes.
And let's move on to item 69 as amended. Mr. City Clerk, open the roll on that, close the roll, and tabulate the vote.
10 ayes.
All right, Mr. Clerk, what's next?
Mr. President, I believe we have general public comment.
All right. Let's move to general public comment. I'd like to call up Adam Smith, Bonnie, Angela L., Harriet Elliott, Kat Ligo, and Tammy Curlon. If you could come up to the left side of council chambers, it doesn't have to be in that order to come up and speak on public comment. You have 1 minute.
Hi, thanks for having me. This is my first time here, so I'm here for cats. I'm here for all animals that are languishing in shelters waiting for their imminent death. There is an overabundance of stray and relinquished cats and dogs in our city shelters. With proper vetting, animal rescuers can help shelters with their overflow by receiving a stipend to help animals, government funded. Animal rescuers do it on their dime. We're already helping relieve the strain on the city. Maybe it's time to help us help you better. As we know, all these shelters are overflowing already. They're left to die. I'm not sure why we're not able to come together like the animal rescuers to relieve their overflow. But I mean, we do it. We do it anyway. We take in cats and dogs. Some of us have 10 cats, 10 dogs. We build catios with our own money. Why isn't that, I mean, I know this is a rhetorical question because you can't answer me, but Is there a way to explore that more?
Next speaker.
Kevin, can you stay for a second? Kevin Gilone.
So nope. Please begin with your general public comment.
First, Ms. Hernandez, thank you for actually being respectful and sitting here and listening. Thank you. I really appreciate it, seriously. It's ironic that Skid Row is 5 minutes away from this beautiful building. As an animal rescuer of 10 years, the crisis in LA, including Skid Row, has not improved. There's a misconception that people on Skid Row have a dog. In reality, most have 2, 3, 5, 8. Last week, we held a privately funded vet clinic. We saw one couple with 8 dogs, one died yesterday, one dog that just gave birth on the sidewalk, a family of 4 dogs that were abandoned, so on and so forth. Dogs are constantly kidnapped and go missing. We started a petition to ask the mayor and Stacey Tains and Kevin to help and enforce spay and neuter. Right now, there are 21,000 signatures. Nothing is being done. Stacey even called Skid Row a lawless hellhole and said incidents on Skid Row are dealt with very, very light-handed enforcement. Animal abusers and breeders laugh in our faces when we say there are laws they have to follow to stop abusing animals. Thank you.
Hi, I'd also like to second thank you for Eunice Hernandez, who's sitting here, and the other council members that are still here. I'm not sure where Kevin De Leon went. Okay, we would like to establish accessible and fully funded spay-neuter clinics throughout the city to provide free or reduced cost services, ensuring that all pet owners can afford to alter their animals. We need targeted community outreach campaigns that should be launched to spread awareness about the spay and neuter law and the availability of these clinics. We also need to enforce mandatory spaying and neutering for all animals leaving the shelters. This policy must be strictly enforced to prevent unaltered animals from contributing to the existing overpopulation problem. GM Stacey Danes has been on the job for over 9 months and so far has nothing to show for it except more and more lives lost.
Hi. Again, thank you for listening. Under the direction of GM Stacey Danes, the shelter is now turning stray cats and most owner-surrendered cats away, leading to an alarming increase in abandoned cats. An actual colony of domesticated cats has formed across the street from the South LA pound because of this. Rescuers are left to provide basic care for these disregarded animals with their own means. While South LA Shelter actually has one cat room that is completely empty and another one that's 70% empty. The new policy goes against what the shelter was intended for, and we demand that you step in and require the shelters to take in any domesticated cat and all kittens. And I would also add that why aren't volunteers allowed? So many animal advocates would like to volunteer, which would ease the financial burden of the city, but for some weird reason, they're not allowed. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Hello, my name is Victoria Beck Parker. Backyard and Skid Row breeding possesses significant ethical and welfare concerns for animals, as well as being a large part of the overpopulation's crisis we are in. By implementing strict penalties and regulations, we can work towards minimizing the negative impact of backyard breeding on animal welfare and population control. We have repeatedly asked Stacey Danes for her help with this without a response. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Louise. I am here. My representative is Neetha Raman, who's not here. She just walked out the minute we started talking. Thank you so much. Sorry, should take this off. Oh, okay. So,
Neetha Raman, who just walked out after we just started talking about animals. And under the direction of GM Stacy Danes, the shelter is now turning stray cats and most owner-surrendered cats away, leading to an alarming increase in abandoned cats. An actual colony of domesticated cats has formed across the street from the South LA pound. Because of this, rescuers are left to provide basic care for these disregarded animals, while South LA shelter actually has one cat room that is completely empty and another room that's 70% empty. This new policy goes against what the shelter is intended for, and we demand that you step in and require the shelters to take in any domestic cat and all kittens. Thank you. I wish there was more of you here. It's really pathetic.
Hi, my name is Kristen Larson, LA Animal Services GM Stacy Dane. Recently sent an email stating that LA Animal Services will only be accepting stray kittens under 8 weeks, but all others will be turned away. She says that keeping cats in 2x2 metal boxes is not a good option over free roaming. It's in the email. Seriously? Most stray cats are friendlies, not ferals, and highly adoptable. It seems her solution for the massive cat overpopulation is to keep putting more and more on the streets unfixed with no discernible plan. She even says that she hopes that we can establish a more effective program that will change the outcome for cats in the future, aka, I have no plan, I have no idea what to do. She also did this in Long Beach, which was a disaster, and put a huge burden on the local rescue organizations there. She doesn't know what she's doing, she's overwhelmed, she breaks down crying all the time, she is not fit to handle this position.
Good afternoon, my name is Ellie and I'm a Los Angeles County social worker. And I have something that I wanted to express. Thank you everyone for being here. Every day animals are losing their lives through no fault of their own. Dogs and cats and rabbits are killed for space, for minor medical issues. Day and day old kittens are killed because there are just too many of them. It is incomprehensible that the LA Animal Service and the City Council have prioritized what it seems like murdering animals instead of focusing on stopping backyard breeding and accidental litters. I ask that you assist us in helping these animals. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Nati Casanova. I live in CD 14 under Council Member Kevin DeLeon. He's not in here right now, but hello. I'm here to ask for stricter laws and enforcement of spaying and neutering of animals in shelters and licensing for breeders, because these breeders are creating this overpopulation problem that's ending up in hundreds of dogs being killed, quote unquote, euthanized. Last year alone in LA shelters, over 6,866 dogs were killed because of this overpopulation. Animals deserve better than that. It's not a no-kill shelter, it's a misleading name. It's actually a selective acceptance shelter. Animals are turned away to die on the streets. They're advised to even dump them. And that's not how we should be treating these animals. They need care, and we need to be using city money properly to take care of these animals. So please, consider revamping the entire shelter system here. Thank you.
Directed energy used to be secretive. Now, in terms of warfare, you can get many books on it. However, in terms of human rights advocate, in terms of human, here is our advocate. His name is Robert Duncan. Do not read him. He is being impersonated right now. Someone killed him and is impersonating his words. The CIA is not playing tiddlywinks, okay? They actually killed this guy. And if you think that he's talking about no touch torture, no implants. If you read anything else, you're reading a phony. This guy is a NATO scientist. NATO scientists don't start saying no implants, no touch torture, and then change their mind. Not a NATO scientist. He's awesome. Robert Duncan. Thank you.
Hello. In a perfect world, every pet would have a loving and safe home. Unfortunately, that is just not the reality. The sad reality is that sometimes animals can pose a safety risk to the public, the staff, volunteers, and even other animals. They come in sick or injured, and we do not have the equipment to humanely sustain them. Brenda Barnett allowed our shelters to become warehouses. We do not have the staff nor the cage space to safely and humanely house these pets. At this time, they are not getting the proper care. Stacy Danes came into an environment that was mismanaged and deceitful for about the last 10 years. To expect anyone to clean up this mess in 8 months is unrealistic. Stacy has made herself available to staff and is involved on site at the shelters. No other GM in my 16 years has done this. What we really need is more funding for public education and community outreach to advocate for the animals to prevent them from ever having to enter our facilities.
Hi, thank you. My name is Angela Yerenas. I am an animal control officer currently assigned to North Central. I'm also a shop steward with SEIU 721. I'm here today to show support for our newly appointed general manager and highlight some of the incredible work that she has accomplished in the 8 months she's been here.
Please hold her time.
Under her administration, she has reduced our critically overcrowded
Speaker, hold on. We're going to pause your time.
By 50%.
So, members of the public, please do not disrupt the public comment.
Develop a fair and transparent process.
Speaker, hold on just 1 second. Your time is paused. Everyone, please do not disrupt the general public comment of other speakers. Sorry. Continue.
She's developed a fair and transparent process to promote an exit pathway for the animals in our system, has recognized and acknowledged the department is grossly underfunded, resulting in a request for more appropriate budget, creating a platform for all internal and external stakeholders to contribute to the future of our department. And she has returned public safety as a priority to our community. We need to adequately staff our animal shelters so they are more a fair working environment for the public, our volunteers, and the community we serve. Thank you.
Members of the public, please do not interrupt speakers that are being allowed to speak. This is your warning. You'll be asked to leave the council chambers if you keep interrupting speakers.
Good afternoon, council members. My name is Cameron Christensen, and I'm Chief Operating Officer of Stray Cat Alliance. Stray Cat Alliance has been around for 24 years, and we've been a partner of Los Angeles Animal Services and the City of Los Angeles. We, on an annual basis, rescue thousands of cats and kittens, the majority of which are pulled from Los Angeles Animal Services shelters. We also run a kitten and cat intervention program based out of South Los Angeles in front of the Los Angeles Animal Services shelter there. I am really excited to see that you are providing more resources and support to the shelters, including in their staffing. It is desperately needed. I wish that I could myself do more and that Stray Cat Alliance can continue to provide the support to Los Angeles Animal Services from the Jefferson Park Animal Care Facility. We occupy that space, as you might know, with Angel City Pit Bulls, as well as CAMP, which provides spay and neuter services close to 5,000 on an annual basis to the community. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Calling a few more names, Paris Herbert Taylor, Maria Tellez, Luisa Alonso, Hector Casas, Adolfo Garcia, Abelardo Lopez, Jose Luis, Edgar Esparza.
Hello, my name is Eve Benuelos. Thank you so much for taking the time to listen to us. I do want to acknowledge how difficult your job must be, having a bunch of random weirdos show up at every meeting to talk about weird things, and today I am one of those weirdos, but I'm not actually a crazy person. I am a native Californian, a very proud Californian. I was born and raised in San Francisco. Both of my parents were social workers for the city and county of San Francisco. I moved to LA when I was 17 to attend UCLA, go Bruins, where I got a BA and master's degree. I taught for 10 years before founding a rescue called Pups Without Borders. I'm here today as part of what I believe to be a civic duty because all of us rescuers who are here have been unfortunately stuck with doing the job that LA Animal Services has not been doing. Even with a 2023 budget of $27 million, this is not appropriate for $27 million. We have been fundraising, having spay and neuter clinics, adoptions, microchips, vaccines, because the city is not doing it, and we are stressed and we are asking for support. Please do not sell breeders' permits when there are dogs being euthanized, or it will just create more of a problem. Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Shira Scott Ashraf. I'm the founder of the Animal Rescue Mission. I decided I really want to be respectful in what I'm saying. I find it so disrespectful that no one is sitting here. I thank you, Unisys, but like Kevin DeLeon, who said he, you know, wants to help the shelters, how dare you not be sitting there right now when you know this is what we're speaking about right now? We said, please stay, and you walked out. The other thing, I'm just not gonna really read my speech, is that Kevin DeLeon said on air the other day, oh, LA is no kill. LA is not no kill. Do you know how much that hurts animals? That doesn't help anybody, except for how you look, and you need to stop caring about how you look. Overall, what I wanna say here is that transparency is needed. Our shelters are disgusting, they're deplorable, they're embarrassing. We need transparency, and we need solutions, because there haven't been any.
Hi, my name is Jacqueline Pignol. I am a Los Angeles tax-paying homeowner. My husband and I own a Marshall Studio small businesses here in Los Angeles. I'm a working actress, and I am the founder of the Canine Condition Nonprofit Foundation that raises funds to offer free spay and neuter for canine companions for families in need, because my city won't provide that. I'm a registered Democrat. I vote. I feel let down by this council and by all of these empty chairs. The conditions of our city animal shelters are deplorable. Have you been to a shelter lately? Have any of you gone to visit the city shelters as of late? LA Animal Services is clearly not able to handle this crisis properly. Today, I am saying, please help us help you. All of us here today are part of a very large and influential voting community in this city. Allow us a pathway toward the solution and fund more spay and neuter programs, which are the solution to the growing overpopulation of innocent homeless dogs and cats being sent to their death every week. I am your constituent, and I demand that you take action and improve this crisis immediately.
My name is Liesl Jackson. I am the VP of Pups Without Borders. I thought I could get through this without crying, but I won't be able to. Every day we get messages begging us to save dogs that are going to be killed, and we are forced to ignore them or decline them because we do not have the space and resources to save them. And I don't understand how the city of Los Angeles can look away from these animals in these deplorable conditions just waiting to die. Knowing there are solutions that can help save so many innocent lives, please stop offering breeder permits, make spay and neuters free and affordable, and give these poor animals a chance before they are killed due to lack of space. There are steps we can take together, and we can make a difference.
Members of the public, we're in danger of losing quorum here in City Council, so we're going to take 10 minutes more of public comment here in the chambers and then 10 minutes on the phone.
My name is Alex Armstrong. I'm a fired Long Beach Animal Care Service volunteer. I've watched
many animals be euthanized in our city shelter. And I would like to speak to you about programs that in other countries are preventing this. We need to stop spay. We need to stop breeding. We need to have spay and neuter programs. The country of the Netherlands has done this. It's three times the size of LA County. It's twice the population. They have no stray dogs in that country. They have half empty shelters because they have a government enforced, provided spay and neuter program. Why can't we do that here in LA County and stop this madness? Why are we spending money on euthanasia and not spending money on stopping breeding? That's it. That's all you gotta do. Take the same money that you're spending on killing animals and spend it on stopping them being born. That way your staff, your volunteers, won't have to go through this hell, and the rescues can do their job without all this. That's all I gotta say.
My name is Ellen Ballandante, and I'm gonna keep this short and sweet. I am a resident of Los Angeles, taxpayer, homeowner, and avid voter. I am also the founder of Deity Animal Rescue and Foundation. I am here today to speak on behalf of all of the animals who have and will experience the hell that is Los Angeles City shelter system. I speak on behalf of those whose lives have and will end there. Spay and neuter is the answer. We cannot rescue our way out of this. If spay and neuter were to be enforced by even 25% this year, the decrease in unwanted births would be enormous and the budgetary strain on the shelters would lessen. That's less animals to feed, less animals to house, and less animals to give medical care to. To every precious soul that has been affected by our devastated system, please know that your life mattered, and in your honor, we will continue to fight. Thank you, Council, for hearing me today.
Richard Serrano, public comment. You have a lot of volunteers here to help LA shelters. They're here, they wanna help those animals. They got their own things going on here. You got officers working on a bounce back program in animal control. That means they show up to work 11 times a month if they want to, for more than their salary. Just like LAPD, you have 200 officers on that bounce back. You guys are trying to do budget control? Look where your money's at. Pay attention. These people want to help these animals. Give them the chance to do so.
Hi, my name is Jessica. I'm a veterinary technician of 16 years, and I've never seen this. Hi, my name is Jessica, and I'm a veterinary technician of 16 years, and I've never seen our LA animal shelter this bad. You know, under the GM's new labeling system, a dog is now deemed to be dangerous or unsafe and is alerted to be killed because they do not do well in the playgroup and have not gotten into fights that setting. This, I suspect, is being done to kill more dogs using the excuse of behavior so the department doesn't have to admit to killing for space, which is the horrible reality of the current shelter state. Most of the dogs labeled as dangerous have no bite histories with humans or zero negative handling notes by staff, volunteers, and grooming during bathing time. They are being given the false label of dangerous so that Ms. Danes can perpetuate this idea that she is doing the community a public service by killing these dogs rather than just admitting that the shelter needs kennel space. Stop killing and stop breeding.
My name is Jessica Powell. I'm a business owner, dog behavior professional, and previous shelter department manager. There's currently no education budget for staff training. It's not just about hiring more staff. They need training in low stress handling, dog body language, and proper enrichment routines. These deficits are all resulting in soaring stress levels and a high rate of bites. Kennel designs are outdated, consistently wet and filthy, with dogs slipping around in their own feces, and basic husbandry needs not being met. I propose dedicated animal task forces for collecting data and operating in the field to concentrate on tackling backyard breeders, allowing breeding licenses to be issued via a simple online or over-the-counter transaction without a home or facility check, or to the homeless population themselves without establishing breeding practices is irresponsible and contributing to the overpopulation problem. Groups of officers trained in dealing with human mental health issues or paired with social workers in specifically dealing with Skid Row. This community has been abandoned for too long and it should be deemed its own city or district. Thank you for listening.
I agree with all of her points made. My name isn't important. I'm literally an animal just like all of you. These animals in the shelters as well are just animals. If I got a runny nose and was labeled unfit for adoptability, then I would be euthanized as a human being, the same animal as a dog, an animal. So I don't believe it is right to euthanize animals based on conditions that they're put in the shelters. They're kept outside during the winter and they get colds, then euthanized for runny noses, so the loophole is that they can get their euthanasia bonuses. And instead, I think that they do need to employ more people. There's no on-site groomers. There's no basin to even wash these dogs that come in bloody or covered in fecal matter and smelling putrid and rotten, and then expecting the general public to adopt these dogs and then get these diseases that are contractible to these human beings, such as giardia, scabies. These dogs are sitting in shelters spreading these diseases to other dogs that then these adopters, these fosters, these people going in can get. So far this year, I've rescued 17 dogs, and tomorrow I'm getting 8.
Speaker,
I'm one
your time
person.
Has expired.
Good afternoon, council members, whoever is left. My name is Gail Raff, and I'm a voter in District 2. I have to tell you that I'm here to ask you for your help. And stopping Los Angeles Animal Services in becoming or is a managed care intake shelter. That needs to end. Los Angeles Services are refusing to accept stray and friendly cats, kittens over 8 weeks, and owner surrenders have to make an appointment, which is over a month away, by using this horrible policy called managed care, which was created after COVID. Councilmember Lee, I think you remember that because we fought to have the shelter, at least West Valley, opened. This is an illegal process by allowing unfixed cats in the city of Los Angeles to be released and told to put them back. Thank you.
All right, so for general comment, you should let everyone speak. If you can go until 3 o'clock to try to suppress people from speaking, you can also go until 3 o'clock to hear everyone. Kevin, you got 8,000 votes. All the other candidates, including Isabel Arado, who's ahead of you, have 26,000 votes. You're going to lose badly. It's absolutely disgusting that your entire presentation on violence against women was just a pro-Israeli government, pro-genocide, you know, thing. Free Palestine, you all should call for a ceasefire. And you do need to work to help improve the conditions in the shelters. You know, I did adopt a dog a couple years ago, adopt a dog. And, you know, she was in a kennel with, like, 5 other dogs. You know, they're not being taken care of. It's, you know, it's really out of control. And Paul needs to resign, too. Thank you.
Hi. Can you hear me? My name's Samantha Goodman. I'm from CD13. And I would like to start my comments by stating that some of the council people here show great disrespect to their constituents by not even being here to listen to what we have to say. If you hadn't noticed, people who care about animals cover many different demographics within your constituencies. That should be important to you, important enough that you give us the courtesy of your attention, because we impact votes. That being said, Mayor Bass, GM Stacy Danes, and LA Animal Services are unwilling to admit that we are in this crisis because of their inability to control the pet population with innovation, mass spay and neuter events, or spay and neuter enforcement. Instead, their answer to the problem is to kill their way out of it, labeling dogs as aggressive or dangerous as a way to send them to their death. Thank you.
That will be the last speaker for public comment here in Council Chambers. Let's move to the phone, please.
Caller, please press star 6 to unmute yourself.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. You have 1 minute for general public comment.
Thank you. Council members, I'm someone who cares greatly about my community and other issues, equestrian issues, and I have seen this Porter Ranch specific plan amendment get approved with lightning speed. We have submitted comments with genuine valid concerns, and every step of the way, they were ignored. They were ignored at CPC. They were ignored at Plum. Plum actually took the item under consent, knowing there were letters of concerns that were raised. And then, of course, we have today. So it's, you know, this is a due process problem, and I think it's also abuse of power. If you're not going to at least discuss the valid concerns and ignore the public comments, this is a fundamental problem and a big concern.
Caller, your time has expired. Next caller.
Hi. Let's see. I wanted to speak on item 52, which you already voted on, of course, which is to plant trees in tree division zones, which is great. Problem not being addressed is twofold, though. The San Fernando Valley needs more trees than the other side of the hill because the San Fernando Valley gets much hotter in the summer. And we need more trees planted, basically. And then secondly, maintenance. Trees need to get trimmed. San Fernando Valley lost a number of trees in this last wind event. Every major wind event, we lose mature trees. So San Fernando Valley council members, the three of you that are still around, you need to start to address this. Lastly, Councilmember Hernandez, thanks for your discussion about body shaming. I thought that was really great, and thanks for still sitting around listening to us.
Okay, next caller.
Caller, please press star 6 to unmute yourself.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, but please turn down the volume on your other device. You have 1 minute for general
public
comment.
All right, sorry about that. All right, so talking about Israeli diversity, two people of different religions cannot marry in Israel. They sterilize Ethiopian Jews by giving them contraception without consent. Let's talk about Israeli honesty. They lied about 40 beheaded babies. Turns out that was a lie. The New York Times article about Hamas mass rape, turns out the writer for that was a former Israeli intelligence officer, and it was all full of lies. They claimed a calendar with a hit list, turns out that was a lie, and the tunnel under that hospital was actually, they admitted, they built it themselves. Most moral military, over 30,000 people have been killed in Gaza in just a few months. They keep killing people waiting for aid. According to the UN, they committed an atrocity when they massacred over almost 200 peaceful protesters during the Great March of Return. They critically injured thousands of people. They bombed hospitals all the time. I think they bombed almost every single one with a NATO unit in it. They also blew up the oldest Christian church, I think, in the world in Gaza. They also killed unarmed hostages that were...
Caller, your time has expired. Next caller.
You can try to talk on my... Oh.
Caller, please press star 6 to unmute yourself.
Hello. Thank you, council members. LA Animal Services has
big problems, including woefully inadequate spay-neuter and spay-neuter enforcement. Stacey Danes brings only small ideas and a plan to keep killing, but with a new excuse for the killing. She's forcing cats without sterilization onto the streets to procreate and die traumatically there. Why? So she won't have to include them in her stats or do the work to help them. Looking the other way about backyard breeding and issuing even one breeder permit is inexcusable. It is now unquestionable that a new general manager is required and that more spay-neuter funding is required. Many great ideas heard today. We need you, council members, and the mayor to please listen. Please care. Please provide desperately needed spay-neuter funding and insist on enforcement. It's cost-effective in the long run. And please get the animals and the public a new general manager, this time with effective and honest plans. Thank you.
Next caller.
Caller, please press star 6 to unmute yourself.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, you have 1 minute.
Okay, this one's for Councilmember Rahman. How can it be permissible? She compromised her principles. Her money is so powerful. The grifting is so palpable. Her friends are paid and endorsed. Her personality's forced. She bends and conforms to the Zionist course. She used to look good to me, but now I find her nothing but corruptible. She runs and hides. There's no telling where her office went. She tells lies. That is something that we know. She falls so easily when backed against the wall. She gives excuses that we've all heard before. She's breaking promises while Paul just breaks the law. She used to look good to me. Now I find her nothing but corruptible. Shout out to Smoke and Scan and a big fuck you to the IDF, Israel, and Kevin DeLeon.
Before we move on to the next caller, Councilmember Soto Martinez, you have an announcement?
Yes, thank you so much, Council President. Just letting my colleagues know in the public that we'll be pushing back the Civil Rights Committee to 1:30. Thank you.
Next caller.
Caller, please press star 6 to unmute yourself.
Yes, thank you. It's Eric Previn. I'd like to give a general public comment and note that I was omitted during the agenda items. Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
How much time do I have?
We just restarted your time. You have 1 minute.
So I have 1 minute? Are you not denying? You're not very chatty today, Grote. Are you denying
yes,
comments?
Yes, you have
on
1 minute for general public comment, okay. And it is going on right now.
Okay, well, this morning you had a little meeting of Padilla's committee, and there were no public speakers at all. There were items including the $160 million for the Olympics, which was completely, we seem to be off plan slightly. This is all while the council was over in Europe and Japan. There's also in that little meeting, Don Lee and Krikorian want to make sure that their staff can get pickup trucks. I find very shocking. And I have to say, I stand with many of the speakers today who were put off by the Women's Month celebration from this body who is behaving in such a awkward way, covering up so many things, including the 5.75.
Mr. Previn, your time has expired. Next caller.
Caller, please press star 6 to unmute yourself.
Yes, hi there. How are you guys?
Good. So you have 1 minute for general public comment.
Yeah, definitely. So I think LA's made a lot of good progress. We talked about sustainability, and I saw that was one of the items, and obviously we have a lot of health of mind that's going on. I think with expungement reform, we're doing great there. I'd really like for us to, as a body, to look at the fact that people that have exonerated mugshots or anything that's online, that is still online. And you can easily look that up as opposed to doing a background check. A lot of recruiters nowadays, they do a Google search because that's free. I'm hoping that we can come as a committee and look and see what it would look like to withhold releasing mugshots or any kind of information like that for certain type of arrest. Those that are nonviolent, things of the sort. I've seen other states do that. And also to copyright mugshots and copyright information to bypass what's called Section 230 of the Federal Communications Decency Act. A lot of people are losing out.
Caller, your time has expired.
Thank you.
All right, that will close public comment. Mr. Clerk, what's next? Oh, sorry. Yeah. We're going to move to reconsider item number 67. So if we can please open the roll on item number 67, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
10 ayes.
And now let's continue item number 67 to Wednesday, March 20th. Without objection, that will be the order. Mr. Clerk, what's next?
And Mr. President, just to reiterate on the record, Council has referred item 29A to the Trade, Travel, and Tourism Committee.
That is correct.
Before the council, council has motions for posting and referral.
Posted and referred.
The desk is clear.
All right. Members, any announcements? Seeing none, can we all rise for adjourning motions? Any adjournments on my right?
Any on my left?
Any on my left?
Mr. McCosker.
Members of the public, we are still in the middle of this meeting. The adjourning motions are part of this meeting, so you are subject to warnings and being removed. So please be respectful while we try to go through the adjourning motions.
Would everyone please rise for adjournments?
Thank you very much, Mr. President and members. Colleagues, I ask that we adjourn in memory of Annette Sikatich.
Excuse me, Mr. McCosker.
Members.
That's one warning.
Mr. President and members, thank you very much. Colleagues, I ask that we adjourn in memory of Annette Sikatich, a beloved wife, teacher, an artist, a promoter of the arts.
Mr. McCosker, I apologize. Sorry. Mr. Spindler?
I'm going to start over, warned. Mr. President, with your permission.
Of course. Okay, you've been warned. Sergeant Arms, can you please remove Mr. Spindler from the meeting?
Mr. Spindler, you have been warned multiple times just now. You are still disrupting this meeting, and the council president has asked that you be removed pursuant to Council Rule 7 and Rule 12. Mr. Spindler, you need to leave this meeting, and you need to do so quietly. We are in the middle of the adjourning motions. And for the record, Mr. Spindler is still refusing to leave the room.
All right, Mr. McCosker, I apologize for the interruption.
Thank you.
Camille Lewis, this is your first and only warning. Please do not disrupt the adjourning motions of this meeting. I'm sorry, Mr. McCosker.
Thank you, colleagues. I ask that we adjourn in memory of Annette Sikatich, a beloved wife, teacher, artist, sponsor of the arts, who passed away on March 1st in San Pedro. Annette was a lifelong member of the San Pedro community and very dear to my wife Connie and I and to our entire family. She was the executive director of Findings Art Center in downtown San Pedro, a center that began as a community art gallery, and also she founded the Findings Women's Project, which helps immigrant women of diverse heritage build entrepreneurial skills and discover their creative capabilities through designing art pieces and textiles that enrich their lives and benefit their entire communities. She was also the director of the Family Literacy Center, a national program sponsored by Toyota that helps parents improve their parenting and literacy skills while providing children early childhood education. My wife Connie and Annette worked together for years in that family literacy program, which changed the lives of entire families and lifted them up for future generations. In October 2010, she joined the artists at Angel's Gate with her working studio in support of Findings. She served as a member of the Artists in Classrooms program at Angel's Gate Cultural Center and as a service learning advisor and adjunct professor at the former Marymount, California University. Annette's adult life mirrored her faith, a life committed to helping women and youth. In the 1980s, she served as youth director at Holy Trinity Catholic Church in San Pedro and helped organize Catholic youth from around the South Bay and the Harbor area to demonstrate their commitment to peace. She was also the coordinator of citizenship and English learning programs at the San Pedro Narbonne Community Adult School, another place where my wife and she worked together. She's a deep mentor to my wife and to our entire family. Annette passed away peacefully at home with her husband by her side. Annette was 75 and she survived by her husband, Nick, her son, Nikki, and her daughter, Mia. Annette's celebration of life will take place on Wednesday, March 20th at 11 a.m. at the neighborhood church at 415 Paseo del Mar, Palos Verdes Estates. We needed to find a place that was looking out over the ocean. It was, her family came from Croatia. Her life and generations of her family all centered around the ocean, and we found a beautiful space for her. I know Mia and Nick and Big Nick are devastated, but our thoughts and prayers are with them. She will be missed by so many in my community. She's a gigantic figure in the Harbor area. May she rest in peace.
Thank you, Mr. McCosker. Members, any other adjourning motions? Seeing none, this meeting is adjourned.